Hi everyone, welcome. My name's Jo Kirby and I'm the Executive Director of the Victoria Law Foundation. Firstly, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which we meet, their elders past and present. Well, welcome to Law Talks. You're going to have a really exciting day. The first part of the day is going to be here in the theatreette, and then you're going to spend the afternoon looking at a culpable driving moot and then touring Old Melbourne Jail. So there's lots of variety. You won't be sitting here all day. You'll have time to stretch your legs and get a better look around. Law Talks is part of the Foundation's education program. We try to reach out to students in rural, regional and disadvantaged schools and give them the opportunity to find out more about the legal system in engaging ways. And hopefully at the end of today's session, that's what you're going to have received. Our first speaker today is Rob Holles, ex-Attorney General of Victoria. I have heard him speak a number of times and he is a very open and interesting speaker. He's going to be talking today on passion to make positive difference. Obviously, if you're Attorney General of Victoria for such a long period of time, you really do have opportunity to look at how laws are made and make a difference to the way the Victorian community views justice. So take the opportunity both to listen to Rob, but also to ask him questions and find out a deeper understanding. Can I please welcome Rob to the stage? One thing, Fabiola will not forgive me if I don't say this, and I won't forgive myself, but it is actually the first day of Law Week today, and you should have all picked up, hopefully, a postcard of Law Week in your little bags. If you go online, you can have a look at the whole program. There's lots of stuff happening on, so if you enjoy today, go along to the other sessions, and I can highly recommend on Saturday, Courts Open Day, where all the courts throw their doors open. You can go and hear a mock trial, you can go and look at the courts, talk to judges, so please check that out. Apologies, and welcome Rob.
Thanks, Jo.
Good on you, thanks very much, Jo. I too want to start by paying my respects to the traditional custodians of the land on which we meet. And it seems not that long ago, although it is a long time ago, that I was really sitting where you were sitting. I was somebody who was very interested in the law as a student. I did legal studies in years 11 and 12. And it was the legal studies at school that made me realise that there's an opportunity to use the law where you can to change people's lives. And I guess it was doing legal studies that made me realise that I actually wanted to study law when I finished school. I thought that would be a great career opportunity. I thought being qualified as a lawyer.
Sorry, Mr. Hull, we've got a big group about can you hold for one?
No, we're going to keep going. They're late, bugger them. There are seats down the front, guys. Don't be scared. Joe going to reintroduce me? What's full of you?
No, Robert Stableford.
Righto, guys, thanks for joining us. You missed the introduction by Jo Kirby. She's gone, but what she said is I'm fantastic. I'm former Attorney General of the State of Victoria, former Deputy Premier, and she raved on and on and on for about half an hour. Noble Park, you missed all that, so I won't bore you with it, but I was just saying that it wasn't so long ago when I remember sitting in seats just like these as a legal studies student in years 11 and 12, and I found legal studies interesting. I thought I could use legal studies ultimately as an opportunity to get into the law. And I decided when I finished school that I actually wanted to study law. And the reason I wanted to study law was to use a legal background to try and change people's lives for the better. The trouble is that my marks at school were nowhere near good enough to get into law. They were pretty ordinary marks. I worked as hard as I could, but there was no way I was getting into a law course. And so people around me, family and friends, said to me, Hulsey, that was my nickname, because my name's Rob Hull, so Hulsey. Hulsey, you better give up the idea of doing law. There's no way you're going to be a lawyer. Your marks, nowhere near good enough to do law. Think of doing something else. And I could have taken their advice and given up on the idea of doing law, or I could have told them to shove it and indeed to continue with my desire and passion to do law. And I chose the latter. I got into arts at La Trobe University, and every day I was out at La Trobe, I thought about doing law. There was a law course at RMIT at the time called the Article Clerk course, where you went to lectures during the day, in the morning and at night, but you worked in a lawyer's office during daylight hours. It was a very practical course. Lectures in the morning, lectures at night, worked in a lawyer's office during the day. And I wanted to do that course. I thought that's a really practical course, a fabulous way of doing law, but my marks weren't good enough. So each day at La Trobe, not only did I think about doing law at RMIT, but I wrote. I actually wrote. Didn't have emails in those days. I actually wrote handwritten letters to RMIT on a daily basis, virtually, begging them to let me into their law course. So much so that I'm pretty sure I was stalking RMIT. And in fact, I know I was, because when I became Attorney General, I introduced stalking laws. And I know I was breaching those laws when I was at La Trobe Uni. In any event, I wrote to them, and finally, after about 6 months, they wrote back to me. Got home, there was a letter from RMIT, and they said, stop writing to us. If you pass first year arts at La Trobe, there will be a place for you in law at RMIT. It was extraordinary. And I did pass just arts at La Trobe, and I got into law at RMIT. And all my dreams had come true. I wanted to do law as a kid, marks weren't good enough, finally got into the law course at RMIT. And I guess the message there is, don't be put off by those doomsayers. I'm sure you meet them every day. You'll have people coming up to you, oh, you're not good enough to do this, oh, you're not good enough to do that. Just ignore them. If you have passion, and indeed you work hard enough, and you think outside the square, you can achieve anything you want to achieve. And I got into the law course. So I finished my law, and a whole lot of people were telling me, you're ordered to practice law in Melbourne. But as soon as I finished my law, I went overseas. Had to borrow money, had no dough, but went overseas for 9 months just to see what was happening out there in the real world. And I came back and I realised there's a lot more to the law than walking up and down Bourke Street or Collins Street in a pinstripe suit. I decided, having broadened my horizons by going overseas, to do legal aid work here in Victoria. And so I went and worked for legal aid out at Broadmeadows for a while, and then down in Frankston, because my parents lived down on the Mornington Peninsula. And then I saw a job advertised working with an Aboriginal legal service in Mount Isa, North Queensland. I'd never met an Aboriginal person in my life, never been to North Queensland in my life. And I just thought, what will it be like if I take myself outside my comfort zone for a while? Will that be a life-changing experience? I don't know. And to be frank with you, I was shit scared. Like, I was really scared going up to a place like North Queensland, not knowing a soul, on my own, but I did it. And I remember going to my father one day and said, I've applied for a job in Mount Isa and I'm going to go and work there. And he was living on the Mornington Peninsula and he said, what the hell do you want to work in Mount Isa for? And I said, no, not Mount Isa, Mount Isa. And we dug out a map to see where Mount Isa was, and it is in the middle of nowhere. And he said, good luck to you. And off I went on my own. And I remember the plane landing one hot February day in Mount Isa. I got out of the plane and 42 degrees just hit me in the face. And I thought, what sort of heat wave are they having in this godforsaken place? It was no heat wave, it was just a normal day in Mount Isa. It's a bloody hot place. And then about 3 days later, I was on a light aircraft travelling to a place called Mornington Island in the Gulf of Carpentaria. When you leave here, dig out a map of Australia and you'll see what I'm talking about. Gulf of Carpentaria, that pointy bit of Australia goes around there. There's a little island out in the Gulf of Carpentaria called Mornington Island. And my job was to represent Aboriginal people who'd been charged with offences at the Mornington Island Magistrates Court. There I was, marks not good enough to get into law, finally get into law, finally start practising law in Melbourne. I find myself up in Mount Isa on Mornington Island as a junior baby lawyer, really, representing the most disadvantaged members of our community. Aboriginal kids being jailed at 16 times the rate of their non-Indigenous counterparts. Aboriginal women being jailed at 14 times the rate. Police treating Aboriginal people like fourth-class citizens. I got to Mornington Island, and I remember I said to the police, well, where do I interview my clients? Where do I interview them? I have to take instructions from them. And the copper said, they're all sitting out there under the guilty tree. Police called it the guilty tree. It was the only place in front of the courthouse where you could get shade in 43 degrees. It was a big tree where everyone sat under it just to get shade, but the police said anyone who sits under that tree, because they're Aboriginal, must be guilty of something. And so the cop called it the guilty tree. The police station, where my clients had been interviewed by the police and often bashed by the police, was turned into, once a month, a courtroom. So the same room where my clients had been interviewed by the police was the exact same room that they were supposed to be getting independent justice meted out to them in a courthouse. All the police did was change the sign, took the police station sign down and put up a magistrate's court sign. That was supposed to be independent justice. When I was travelling on the plane to Mount Isa, the magistrate was on the plane, Mornington Island, the magistrate was on the plane, the police prosecutor was on the plane, I sat at the back of this light aircraft, and I heard the conversation between the police officer and the magistrate, and they were talking about what sentences they were going to impose on my clients before they'd even heard the case in court. That was supposed to be independent justice. Can you imagine how my mind broadened almost overnight to how unfair our justice system can be if it doesn't operate independently? So I stayed in Mount Isa. I was only going to be there for 1 year. I ended up staying for 8 years. Lived in Mount Isa for 8 years. And on a case-by-case basis, I think I was making a difference to my clients. I think what I said in court often was keeping them out of jail, or indeed ensuring they got a lesser penalty than they would have got had they been representing themselves. But let me give you an insight into the way the justice system actually worked in that part of the world at that particular time. When I arrived in Mount Isa, a police sergeant was leaving the town, got a promotion, was going somewhere else. He said, oh, you're the new bloke from Melbourne. You're here to represent Aboriginal clients, aren't you? And I said, yeah. He said, mate, say if I was to tell you that last night in the Mount Isa watch house, there was an Aboriginal fella who was arrested just for being drunk and disorderly, and as a bit of a game, the watch house sergeant and another police officer force-fed him cockroaches in the watch house. And I laughed, and I said, oh, yeah, bullshit. And he said, see, your reaction is exactly the same sort of reaction that the magistrate will give when the Aboriginal person makes this accusation in court. No one will believe it, but it happened. I saw it. That's the sort of situation you're dealing with in the legal system out here in remote northwest Queensland. And he was dead right. It was horrific. The racism up there, I'd never seen anything like it before. The justice system and the way it dealt with Aboriginal people was extraordinary. I'd never seen anything like it before or since, for that matter. And so I decided that representing people on a case-by-case basis, as good as it was, wasn't systemically changing our justice system. And that's why I decided, when I was up in Mount Isa, to run for politics, run for parliament, to see if I could actually get into parliament and make changes to the laws to ensure that our justice system became more culturally sensitive, particularly for Aboriginal people. And funnily enough, I got elected. I got elected to federal parliament, would you believe, up in North Queensland. I was a 32-year-old kid from Melbourne, went up to Mount Isa, marks not good enough to get into law, Aboriginal legal aid lawyer, and then a federal member of parliament. Quite an extraordinary opportunity as a kid to make changes. And I knew I was only going to be there for a short time, and I'd spent as much time as I could changing the infrastructure needs of Aboriginal communities. Some of these communities, 1,200 people, didn't have water for 24 hours a day. Can you imagine that? Not being able to go to the toilet except during certain times of the day, not being able to have a shower or a bath except during certain times of the day. Imagine little kids having to cope with that. So I was able to work as hard as I could to get infrastructure into some of those communities, including appropriate dams, water infrastructure and the like. Well then, as happens with most politicians, I lost my seat up in North Queensland to a Rhodes Scholar you've probably heard of called Bob Catter. Yeah, I'm the one to blame for Bob Catter being in federal parliament. I apologise for that. And I came back to Melbourne. Politics was in my blood. I ran for parliament in Victoria, got elected. Then we won government in 1999, probably before many of you were born. I was sworn in as the state's attorney general. Can you imagine that day when I'm at Government House and I'm being sworn in by the governor as the chief law officer of the state of Victoria, the Attorney General? My mind was just thrown back to those days when I was at La Trobe University, when I was at school, when I was sitting like you guys as a year 11 or year 12 student who's doing legal studies. And I'm just thinking, I'm being sworn in as the state's chief law officer. My marks weren't good enough to get into law when I was a kid. And here I am now being sworn in as the state's attorney general. And I was so pleased with myself, not because I was being sworn in as attorney general, but because I didn't listen to those doomsayers who kept saying, you've got no chance of doing law. And I was also pleased because I took myself outside my comfort zone and went up to Mount Isa and did all the Aboriginal legal aid stuff. It was a life-changing experience. So, as Attorney General, I quickly started to implement a whole range of reforms based on my experience in Mount Isa. I introduced a series of Koori courts here in Victoria based on my experience in Mount Isa. I introduced specialist family violence courts because I knew that there was a huge issue with family violence, but women weren't reporting family violence because the infrastructure in our legal system wasn't encouraging women to come forward and report family violence. So I had specially trained magistrates, specially trained police officers, specially trained court staff that actually understood the holistic nature of family violence. And as a result of setting up those specialist courts, more and more women felt it was fine to come forward and report family violence, which is a great thing. I also set up a mental health court here in Victoria because mental health is a huge issue. Our jails are full of people who have mental health issues. Our justice system isn't dealing with them in an appropriate manner. So I set up a specialist mental health court here in Victoria, a specialist drug court to deal with people who are committing offences as a result of their drug addiction. And indeed, I set up the Neighbourhood Justice Centre in Victoria, which is a one-stop justice shop where people can get holistic specialist support under the one roof for all the issues that are bringing them before the court. You see, the view I took, based on my experience in Mount Isa, is that where it can, the justice system should try and be a positive intervention in people's lives. Our lives go along this sort of track, you know, and you'll have your ups. You might win Tats Lotto one day, who knows, and you'll be on a high, and you have your downs. And sometimes those downs can bring you into contact with the justice system. The justice system can either spiral you further and further into the mire, or it can actually lift you up and ensure that you continue to be a productive member of our community. In many cases, the old justice system would deal with you for a specific issue. You're broken into my house, you've stolen my TV, you're going to jail for doing that, a break and enter. Modern therapeutic justice should be asking, well, hang on, why have you broken into my house? To steal my TV, because you want to sell the TV to feed your drug and alcohol addiction. And that's as a result of your drug and alcohol addiction. There's also mental health issues that are built up, and as a result there's long-term homelessness, long-term unemployment, and you've been a victim of family violence. Unless the justice system can deal with all those issues in a holistic way, we just create a revolving prison door where people go in and out of prison and we end up spending more money on prison beds than hospital beds and school classrooms. And that's certainly not the sort of society I want to live in. So as a result, I introduced all these therapeutic, restorative, problem-solving courts to deal with people's issues in a holistic way. Let's not kid ourselves, there are some bad bastards out there that need to be locked up for a long period of time. No question of doubt about it.
But if you look at the demographics of the people in our jails, the majority of them have issues that have never been dealt with appropriately. Acquired brain injury, mental health, they've been victims of family violence. Our justice system in the past hasn't dealt with those issues in an appropriate way. Hopefully, the specialist courts are able to do that. And I guess if, and I want to open up to questions, if I was to leave you with a couple of messages. Oh, by the way, I then retired from State Parliament and I've set up the Centre for Innovative Justice here at RMIT. What's that, you might ask? It's a centre of excellence for learning, teaching and research in relation to smarter ways of delivering justice, along the lines I've just spoken to you about. We offer students the most amazing hands-on clinical education experience in holistic justice. We have re-established the Mental Health Legal Centre here on site at RMIT, right next to the Centre for Innovative Justice, where our students, and not just law students, but students from a whole range of other disciplines as well, including social work students, come and get a hands-on experience opening up real files of real people in real jails to assist them with all their other legal issues that build up whilst they're in jail, and then for 6 months after they're released from jail. So a woman might go to jail for a drug offence, for instance, but while she's in there, there's family law issues, there's tenancy issues, there's just debts, a whole range of issues build up while she's still in jail. And when she comes out of jail, she's still embroiled in the justice system, and that can lead, obviously, to recidivism, to her re-offending and going back to jail. This clinic that we have at RMIT that our students work in assists female prisoners at Dame Phyllis Frost in relation to all their other legal issues. We also do research in a whole range of cutting-edge areas, family violence, sex offences, access to justice, people with acquired brain injury in the prison system, people who have been in culpable driving matters, and we get students involved in that research as well. And we also offer students short, sharp taster placements, where I might place a student shadowing a Koori Court magistrate for a week, or a drug court magistrate for a week, or the mental health court magistrate for a week. So it changes the lives of these students and opens up a whole world of possibilities for them. So that's what I'm doing now, out of politics, into the Centre for Innovative Justice at RMIT, and have a very close association with the Mental Health Legal Centre. But if I had to leave you with two messages, they're pretty simple. And I hope that you remember these, not just for the rest of the day, but really for the rest of your life, because it changed my life. The first is, don't ever be put off by those doom and gloom merchants who'll be on your back on a regular basis, having a go at you, telling you you're not good enough, your marks won't be good enough, you're not good enough to do this, you're not good enough to do that. It's a nonsense. I've got no doubt in this room there's a future Attorney General. I've got no doubt in this room there is a Supreme Court judge, a county court judge, a magistrate, a really fabulous immigration refugee lawyer. I have no doubt that any of your aspirations that you have, you can achieve. Just go for it. Work hard, have passion, and go for it, but don't be put off by those doomsayers. First message. Second message is, just once in your life, take yourself outside your comfort zone. Do something that's a bit scary to you, that you think, will I do it, won't I do it? Will I go up to North Queensland, won't I? Just do it. It's hard, it's scary, and from time to time, it can be unfriendly. I had coppers who hated my guts when I was up there in North Queensland. They used to follow me around on a daily basis in their police cars, just harassing me because I was the fella that did the Aboriginal legal aid work. So it was scary, it was hard, but it changed my life. I took myself outside my comfort zone. I did Aboriginal legal aid work. It was a life-changing experience. I was doing something, using my law for social good, and I think it changed my life for the better. And as a result of that, I became the senior law officer of the state of Victoria. And on a daily basis, Mark's not good enough to get into law, senior law officer of the state of Victoria, became deputy premier. If I can do it, you guys can certainly do it. So just remember those things. Take yourself outside your comfort zone. Don't be put off by the doomsayers. You can make a real difference to lives of your fellow Australians, your mates, and indeed
your own lives. Thanks for listening. I'll try and answer any questions you might have. Sorry, just repeat that.
Do you think there are key qualities you need to cultivate in order to be a good lawyer, besides passion for law?
Yeah. Look, you've got to be a good listener, but to be absolutely frank with you, Phil Cummins, who heads up the Law Reform Commission here in Victoria, and I'm sure he'll have something to add to this, and was a judge of the Supreme Court here in Victoria, a lawyer and judge par excellence. Unless you're able to listen to people and fully understand what they're saying and can speak their language, I don't think you will be a good lawyer. But lawyers alone, in my view, aren't good enough. Because of the complexity of issues in our society these days, I think the legal practices of the future will be ones that are multidisciplinary practices. That is, you have lawyers working alongside social workers, alongside psychiatrists and psychologists, alongside speech pathologists, even GPs down the track, to give this holistic service to people. Because yes, there might be a thin, narrow, isolated legal issue, but it's built upon a whole range of other issues that need to be dealt with. And so that's why we're quite excited about the Mental Health Legal Centre here. On the 14th of June, we have the Vice-Chancellor coming along to open up it as a new multidisciplinary practice, where we're going to have lawyers and social workers, law students and social work students working alongside each other to put wraparound services around clients. And I think that's the way of the future. Lawyers who understand that the issues that are coming before them aren't just legal issues, and the ability to put holistic services around people.
I was going to say, do you want to just talk a bit about the Naval Justice Centre in Collingwood that you set up? That's, I think, an amazing model, because I've actually done a bit of work there through Victorian Legal Service.
So one of the good things you get to do when you are in politics, there are some good things, not all good things, is you get to travel a bit and see what's happening out there in the rest of the world. And I travelled to New York and had a look at the Red Hook Community Justice Centre just outside New York. And I sat on the bench with the judge, Judge Calabresi. He asked me to sit on the bench with him and watch what happened in court that day. And it still sticks in my mind. I can remember a woman coming back before the court to be further assessed in relation to the order that the judge had put her on, a drug treatment order, about a month earlier, to see how she was going, see if she was off drugs still. And the judge had and this gets back to your question, an open and frank conversation with her, talking in her language, basically. And he said, so you've been clean for the last month? And she said, yes, judge, thanks to you. The services you've put around me have been able to ensure that I've stayed off drugs for at least the last month. And he said, did the fact that I was able to get your mother into rehabilitation as well help? And she said, absolutely, because mum was a smack addict. The fact that I was trying to stay off drugs, it was almost impossible while I'm living with my mum, and she was also on smack. And I thought, wow, what sort of court can do this, where the judge can put the particular defendant on a drug treatment order, but the mother, who hadn't really been charged with any offence, agreed with the court that she too would go into rehabilitation. That's holistic support for the family. And I thought, if they can do it here in America, why can't we do it in Melbourne, in Australia? So I came back and spoke to my parliamentary colleagues and said, I've got this great idea. I want to open up a neighbourhood justice centre where under the one roof we have a court, but we also have drug and alcohol treatment. We have assistance for employment opportunities. We have assistance in relation to tenancies. Every issue that a person has in their life, they can get support under that one roof at a one-stop justice shop. And my colleagues, I reckon, thought, oh yeah, good on you, probably another namby-pamby Halsey idea, you know, will it work, won't it work? It was only when I was able to show them
that for each dollar you invest in holistic support, holistic justice, you save $5 or $6 down the track where you don't have to jail as many people, and it's bloody expensive to lock people up in jail, where you stop people re-offending, where you stop people breaching the orders that the court puts them on, that my colleagues thought, ooh, you're saving money. That might be money that can come into my portfolio. Yeah, yeah, we'll support you on that, Halsey. And so my colleagues supported it. And it's been up and running for many years now, and it's actually been evaluated by both Conservative and Labor governments, and it's working. It's changing lives, you know, under the one roof. You go to court, instead of adjourning a matter for a month so you can hopefully get drug and alcohol treatment, the magistrate can actually refer you that same day into treatment. They can find you housing that same day. They can actually assist you with all your issues that same day because they've got the support services under the one roof. It's a fantastic way of delivering justice in a holistic way. And I hope that we have more neighbourhood justice centres open up around Victoria in the not too distant future.
Any other questions?
Come on, guys, don't be shy. Must be a million questions. Yep. Stubbornness, I guess, and also, look, I think if you're passionate about something, you can get through any roadblocks, right? I knew from a pretty early age, because I came from a pretty large family, we had seven kids in the family, we'd sit around the dinner table each night, we'd have arguments about, you know, social justice issues and the like. I had a father who was pretty passionate about the law and passionate about social justice, so that sort of got my social justice juices flowing, I suppose. And I wanted to do something where I thought I could make a positive difference. You know, we can all go about our lives and we can be, you know, selfish as we like and, you know, ignore everyone else in the world, or we can actually try and embrace people, you know, a bit like a team sport. You know, I played footy as a kid, and I loved playing in a team because you work beside your teammates. Some were pretty good, some were hopeless, but, you know, you're a team. And a bit like living in the community, we're a team. We can either work together to ensure the team goes forward and wins premierships, or we can just bag our teammates and get nowhere. I was of the view that I actually wanted to do something that could make a positive difference in my job, and law seemed to be the obvious answer. You know, like, people couldn't afford and still can't afford to get access to justice. You know, wealthy people can, people living in poor communities can't. They can't get access to legal aid in many cases. They can't get access to the same justice that we all expect everyone's getting access to. So I decided to do law to try and improve their lives. And it is true, people said, no, not good enough, give it away. And I could have given it away, but I decided to think outside the square a bit. Well, if my mark's not good enough to get in this year, is there another way of doing it? Is there, you know, a way where I can use my marks, get into a particular course, and then try and transfer over to a law course? And I, you know, looked up every book under the sun, and, you know, did as much research as I could, and I found this RMIT course. It suited me perfectly, and as I said to you, I wrote to them regularly and I stalked them. And I'm so glad I ignored those doomsayers, because it did make a difference. You've got to have passion, but more than that, you've also got to be persistent. There will be people out there who'll try and take you down on a regular basis. Well, let them try, but don't let them do it. You know, they get a kick out of trying. That's, you know, that's bullying. That's a matter for them. They've got to live with that. But you can achieve whatever you want to achieve, and it mightn't be through the front door. But there'll be a side door or a back door somewhere that surely will let you in. Yep?
Did you find, in order to get elected to Parliament and joining a political party, did you have to sacrifice your personal ideals for party policy, or was it?
It's a bloody good question. I guess politics is the art of compromise. And there are a whole range of things I did in politics where I would have liked to have gone further. I introduced a human rights charter in the state of Victoria, for instance. And the human rights charter, we're the only state in Australia with a human rights charter. The ACT has one. But I always find it amusing that we as a country
run around the world lecturing other countries about their human rights records, and yet we don't have a national human rights instrument in this country. The charter I introduced enshrines civil and political rights of people. I would have liked it to have gone further and also include social and economic rights, but I had to compromise because I knew that that would probably be a step too far for not just my colleagues, but probably the Victorian community at that stage. So I want to do it then incrementally, and I put in the charter a review mechanism where it was reviewed after 5 years, and I think 7 years, 10 years, to see whether or not it could be expanded. So I compromised in relation to that. I compromised in relation to a range of other areas, but that doesn't mean that I gave up. Compromise means you get part of what you want with a view to coming back and getting all of what you want down the track. That's my view of compromise anyway. Some might disagree with that. But I reckon I got most of what I wanted achieved, the specialist courts and the like, and appointing women to the bench. I was very keen on ensuring that the legal profession didn't remain a white Anglo-Saxon male-dominated profession. I wanted to appoint people based on merit, but we were kidding ourselves as a community if we thought that women who make up 51% of the population, you know, shouldn't make up a substantial percentage of people on the bench. So a lot of the reforms I introduced through hard work, through being persistent, being passionate, and being bloody loud. If my colleagues thought that I wasn't going to have an argument about particular issues, they were sadly mistaken. I would argue every point about every issue when I went into that cabinet room. And I think sometimes I got stuff I wound up because they thought, oh no, not another blue with Halsey, just give it to him. It was a good life. It was a good life, but it was all consuming. Politics is all consuming. And I knew that it wasn't going to be my last career. I retired at a time of my own choosing and then came over to RMIT. But it's not just what you see on TV in Question Time that politics is about. I'd go to the supermarket, you know, just doing the shopping, and you'd have people coming up to you, hey, you want that bloke? You'd go to the footy, I'm a Mad Geelong supporter. You'd go to the Geelong games and you'd have usually a Collingwood supporter having, oh, there's that bastard Hulls, and they'd say it just close enough for you to hear, but without looking at it. It was 24/7. You'd be criticised on a regular basis by people who didn't like your views. But that's the nature of the game, you know, and I knew I wasn't going to do it forever. And you get in, you try and make a difference, and you get out at the time of your choosing. Can't get much better than that. Yep. Yeah, when I originally decided that law was something that tickled my fancy and I could make a difference in, I think it was criminal law. Criminal law was the most exciting because it's what you read about the most. And, you know, I could see myself doing murder cases and representing people who'd been wrongly charged. You know, I had this aspirational view of the law that people were always being charged with offences that never committed, and I wanted to be a defence lawyer, and I'd actually planned to go to the bar. That is, become a barrister here in Victoria. I planned to read with somebody. I won't bore you with the technical aspects of that, but I planned to become a criminal barrister. I was about to go to the, I think it was the March intake of going to the bar, and I'm sitting in my office at Legal Aid, and I saw this job advertised. Wanted, lawyer to do Aboriginal legal aid work in Mount Isa. And I thought, go to the bar, pretty safe, a lot of my mates are there. Aboriginal legal aid. I've never met an Aboriginal person, but I do know they're being jailed at pretty high rates. I did know from my studies that Aboriginal kids were being locked up at pretty high rates, thinking, they can't all be that bad. Why are they being locked up? Maybe I should go up and see what that's, maybe, no. And really, had a few sleepless nights, should I or shouldn't I? You know, I was living in a pretty comfortable family. We'd go down to my parents' place every Sunday and have a big barbecue with the family and, you know, seven kids and mum and dad, and we could bring our mates. That was pretty comfortable. I'd be taking myself outside that comfort zone. I'd miss my family. Should I do it? Yeah, bloody oath, and I did it. And it was just almost a flip of the coin, you know. But I knew it was going to be criminal law. I knew it was going to be representing Aboriginal clients who'd been charged with criminal offences. And I thought I could make a difference. And I thought I'd only stay up there for a few months, to be frank with you. But after the conversation about the cockroaches, and after what I saw before those courts and what was happening, like, you take instructions from your client, and he might want to plead guilty to something. Yeah, yeah, I broke into the school, and yeah, I stole the, you know, the can of Coke. And then you'd go into court, and you're about to plead guilty, and your client would say, oh, that's him there. And he'd be pointing to the police officer. And I said, that's him what? He said, he's the one who bashed me. I said, hang on, you didn't tell me he bashed you. Yeah, yeah, he bashed me. And I said, whoa. Let's adjourn this matter and get further instructions. And it was a regular thing where my clients were just expecting to be bashed by police if they're arrested. That was part of the procedure. I couldn't believe this. And so instead of staying for what I thought was going to be a few months, as I said, I stayed there 8 years. 8 years living in Mount Isa. And it was the criminal law that excited me.
What did you have to do in your arts course to then get into your...
Way back then, I remember I did Philosophy 101. Which I didn't understand. It was, is it rational to believe in God and all that sort of stuff? It was a really weird subject. I did, I think it was an English subject and something else. To be frank with you, none of it interested me because law was my passion. And I was only doing first year arts to use it as a stepping stone somehow to get into law. So the subjects were so memorable in arts, I can't remember what they were. But it was a means to an end. And I can remember this, though, and this is... I don't want to give you the impression that you don't have to study hard to achieve what you want to achieve. I wasn't the best student, right? I wasn't the best student unless I was doing a subject that I really loved. But I can remember going to see someone out at the airport the day the results for the arts, first year arts, came out. And I knew that if I passed arts, there was a place for me in law. And to be frank with you, I wasn't 100% sure that I was going to actually pass first year arts. And I went out to the airport and then I drove out back to La Trobe University to get my results. And I was shaking, I was nervous. I thought, this is a trip that can either be a huge success or a total failure. I'm going out to get my results to see if I'm getting into law. And I got out to the La Trobe Uni, and in those days they put your results up on a notice board. And I ran over to the notice board, and it's all in alphabetical order. Hulls, H-U-H-U. I couldn't find it. I couldn't find my name. And I almost started crying. I thought, shit, I have blown this. Had I passed arts? I'm in law and I haven't passed arts. And tears started to trickle down my face. And some guy looked at me and said, what's the matter, mate? And I said, arts? I think I failed. He said, mate, you're not looking at arts. That's biology. Arts is over there. Oh, thank God. And I went over. And there was my name on the arts in all the subjects, and I passed, and it was a great trip home. True story. Question up the back. Sorry, Matt. Labor Party.
Very young.
Well, look, I don't want to turn this into a political debate or discussion, but the reason I joined the Labor Party as a kid was because I thought it was a party of social justice. It fitted in with my social justice views, you know. We as a community ought to be reaching down to assist the most disadvantaged members of our community rather than, you know, try and make the wealthy more wealthy, and a bit of that hopefully trickles down to the less well off. That was the only reason I joined. I'm glad I did because it led to me becoming Attorney General ultimately and Deputy Premier under John Brumby. And Brumby was my mate. I knew Brumby when I was in Federal Parliament. he was a Federal Member for Bendigo for a while. Then he became Chief of Staff to a senior Federal Minister, and that's when I met him and we sort of became mates. And then when he became Deputy Premier, in fact, it was, I don't know if you remember this, do you guys do politics at all? Some of you do. When Steve Brax was Premier, and John Thwaites was his deputy, unbeknownst to me, they both resigned on the same day at a cabinet meeting, and I wasn't at that cabinet meeting. I was actually down in Tasmania addressing a whole bunch of lawyers from around the country. And I was at this very important meeting with all these lawyers, including the Federal Attorney General, and my Chief of Staff, while I'm on my feet talking, I could see her in the audience saying, "Come here, come here." And I said, anyway, she actually brought the phone up to me and said, "You've got to come outside, you must take this phone call." And I said, "For goodness sake, I'm in the middle of speaking to this." She said, "The Premier's on the phone." Oh God, what does he want? So, and so I go out of the room and I take the call and he says, "Halsey," and I said, "Steve, I'm just in the middle of giving this lecture on law." He said, yeah, no worries, mate, I'll let you get back to it, but I just want to let you know I've resigned." I said, "What?" He said, "Yeah, I've resigned, but it's time for me to go, and John Thwaites, my deputy's resigned as well. So there's a vacancy for Premier and Deputy Premier." And I thought, my God, what do I do? And he said, "And John Brumby will take over as Premier." And I thought, my God, what do I do? And I quickly finished the speech I gave, and I tried to get on a plane back to Melbourne, and I couldn't get one, because I thought I would be ideal for John Brumby's deputy, but I knew a whole lot of other people would be lining up as well and lobbying him. And I tried to book a plane, and the next plane wasn't going for 2 hours. And so I then chartered, and I wish I hadn't, a light aircraft. And it just reminded me of my days travelling to Mornington Island. I hate light aircraft. They bounce up and down. And the light aircraft took off an hour before the normal jet would take off, and it arrived an hour later than the normal jet. It was the most horrible flight. All these headwinds, up and down, vomit almost coming out on a regular basis. It was so horrible. And I shuffled into John Brumby's office, trying to hold it back. I want to be your deputy. I don't think that was the best pitch I gave him, but in any event, he appointed me as his deputy, so I became Deputy Premier.
One in the front row there.
Yep, sorry.
So you've worked in both federal and state government. What was that like? And also, which do you find more enjoyable?
Good question. I reckon I'm the only person you've ever met, you've met me now, to work in state and federal and local council. I didn't tell you, I was actually elected to local council in Mount Isa when I went up there. Not just that, I was host of the highest rating local television show in Mount Isa called Northwest Sports Update. It was the highest rating because it was the only local sports show in Mount Isa. So a mate of mine was leaving Mount Isa and there was this 5-minute Friday night sports program where any visiting sports people that came to Mount Isa, I would interview. Went to air for 5 minutes on a Friday night. And as a result of that, the guy who was mayor of Mount Isa at the time, and I was doing Aboriginal legal aid work, he said, "Why don't you run for local council here?" And I said, "Local council?" He said, "Oh mate, it's a good training ground for politics." So I did, and I was elected to the Mount Isa City Council. I did that for a couple of years. And then I ran for federal parliament and got elected, and then state parliament. You asked which was the best. I think, because of the timing of my political career, no question state parliament was the best, because I was a senior minister and I could actually do stuff. That's not to say I couldn't do stuff federally, but I was just a little junior burger, I had to beg ministers to come to my electorate because they knew it was probably a safe National Party seat and Halsey was only going to be there for a short time and they were probably reluctant to come and spend much time in my electorate. And most of the time I concentrated on Aboriginal issues. So I was there for 3 years. I was in local council for 2 years. And I was in state parliament for 15, 16, 17 years or something. But that was the best. That was the best because of the positions I held. I held Attorney General all that time. So I'm actually the longest serving Attorney General in Victoria. I held positions such as industrial relations, manufacturing, work cover, a few others, including racing. I was racing minister, which is great because you got really good tickets for the Melbourne Cup. But that was the best time in my political career because I could achieve so much.
Do you have any goals or plans to change anything at the moment?
Oh, bloody oath. I've always got goals and plans to change things. Yes, I do. In fact, one of the projects we're doing at the moment is on culpable driving. Let me just ask you guys a question, because I've addressed students plenty of times in the past. So I ask this question. I say to students, hands up those who think that someone who kills another person
should automatically go to jail? Hands up. Like, number of hands go up, okay? And then I give, then I say, okay, for those of you who've put your hand up, what about this situation? A young kid, no prior convictions, he's the designated driver, his mates are pissed in the back of the car, they're mucking around, he turns around to tell them to shut up, he momentarily loses concentration, puts his foot on the accelerator instead of the brake, slams into a tree, kills his two mates, right? He's killed his two mates. Hands up those who think he should go to jail. No one puts their hands up. One or two might. Well then, smart student at one of these sessions put their hand up and said, oh yes, he didn't deliberately mean to kill somebody. He didn't really mean to kill them. But then I say, okay, hands up those who think someone who deliberately means to kill someone and does should automatically go to jail. Hands up. You think someone, many more people put their hand up. What about this situation? 85-year-old bloke, been married to the same woman for 55 years, 60 years, doesn't have a parking ticket, never broken any law in his life, absolutely adores his wife who is dying of the most incurable, painful cancer. She begs him to give her an overdose of her medication so she can slip off quietly. Finally, after weeks, months of begging, he finally agrees and she dies with her head in his arms. She has a smile on his face. He has tears running down his eyes. He's 85. He's deliberately killed his wife. Hands up those who think he should go to jail. None. And I guess the point of those stories is we've got to deal with each individual case on its merits, right? You read on the front page of the Herald Sun, oh, you know, he killed my son and he only got 6 years. My son's never going to come back. And you see on the Channel 7 news, the grieving victim walk out of court. And we all grieve for them. Of course we do. And the media says, do you think the penalty was enough? And of course the victim's going to say no. But the media never asks, well, how much would be enough? If 6 years isn't enough, would 8 years be enough? Would life be enough? Because your son isn't coming back. And that's what they really want. They want their son to come back. Our justice system can't deliver that. But what our justice system should do is try and ensure that those people are treated with respect and dignity. And the adversarial system that we have currently, I think, has passed its use-by date in a lot of areas. I don't think that the adversarial system in family violence matters is serving victims of family violence or indeed victims of sexual assault very well. Did you know, and we've done research in this area, that 1% only, 1 in 100 victims of sexual assault end up reporting to police, being believed, going through a committal, going through a trial, and it results in a conviction against the perpetrator. 1%. That means 99% of victims are missing out on appropriate justice. Now, either they don't report because they don't know who it was who assaulted them, or it's an old offence and it's Uncle Freddy and it's in the family and they have to see Uncle Freddy every Christmas day and so they don't report, or they do report and the police don't believe there's enough evidence against them, or they do report, the police do believe there's enough evidence, it goes to trial, but the jury says, based on the burden of proof, not guilty. So we're really sitting here and saying, oh well, our justice system is delivering justice to those victims. It's not. So we, at the Centre for Innovative Justice, are looking at better ways of giving victims of sexual assault a much better outcome than the current adversarial process. And it's called restorative justice conferencing. And it's based on the model that's been in existence in New Zealand for 15 plus years, where in a controlled environment, the victim and the perpetrator can sit with people to assist them to work through why the particular offence occurred, and the victim gets a chance to tell the perpetrator how their lives have been ruined as a result of what occurred. Now, it can happen post-sentence, before a perpetrator is released from jail. We're doing the same thing in relation to culpable driving matters. That case I just spoke to you about, a mate killing a mate. You know, the driver goes to jail for 6 years. His life's ruined forever because he's in jail for 6 years and he's killed his best mate. The family of his best mate, their life's ruined forever. Does the adversarial system of justice actually deliver true justice in that situation? I don't think so. So we're looking at running a number of restorative justice conferences in that particular area. There's so much reform that needs to be done. You know, going back to that Channel 7 news, you see the victim walk out of court and we all feel sorry for them. They've lost a daughter, they've lost a son, they've been sexually assaulted themselves. Of course we feel sorry for them. But why as a community do we have this compassion bypass when that victim, as a result of being a victim, falls into drug and alcohol abuse, mental health issues, long-term unemployment issues, homelessness issues, and then they trip over the line and become a perpetrator of a crime themselves? We then have this compassion bypass and say, bugger them, lock them up and throw away the key. And our jails are full of those sort of people. People who have been victims of family violence. People who have mental health issues that have never been addressed. People who have acquired brain injury issues that have never been addressed. Our jails are the 21st century asylums. That's the reality. And we have to frame a justice system that is fairer, that is able to deal with people's issues in a more holistic way. So I'm working on some of those issues.
I think we'll have to finish up again. Thank you so much. Now, our next presentation, we've got another wonderful speaker. In fact, we've got two. We have Philip Cummins, who's the chair of the Victorian Law Reform Commission, and Nick Gadd, also from the Commission, here to talk to you. Philip was a Supreme Court judge for 21 years. He's been the chair of the Victoria Law Foundation. He is now the chair of the Victoria Law Reform Commission. As Mr. Hull said, he's had an amazing career. He's a Supreme Court judge par excellence. He's sat on some amazingly difficult and long trials and some very, very difficult criminal matters. And in his role now as the chair of the Victoria Law Reform Commission, they're doing some wonderful things. I think you have, I think some of the schools have already had someone from the commission come out and speak to them, but today you've got the opportunity to hear from the chair himself. And please welcome Philip Cummins and Nick Gadd from the Victoria Law Reform Commission.
Good morning. So I'm Nick from the VLRC, and I'm here with Philip Cummins, who's the chair of the VLRC. And I'm aware that you have all, I think, done some study of the VLRC already. I imagine you've all done a SAC on the VLRC, yeah, a few months ago? Yeah, is that right? Okay. So, and I think I've probably come and spoken at some of your schools. So I'm not just going to go over all the familiar material again. What I'm going to do is I'm going to, for the first few minutes, I'm going to talk to you about just the fundamentals of the VLRC that you really must know for the VCE exam at the end of the year. After which, Philip and I are going to have a conversation in which we're going to go into some details of the medicinal cannabis project, which we completed last year, which some of you may have looked at. Have some of you looked at the medicinal cannabis reference already?
Yes.
Know anything about that? Yep. All right, well, we'll be going into that, hopefully, into some detail. But for the first few minutes, what I'm going to do is just go over... Oh, that looks a bit big. Okay. So just some of the real fundamentals of the VLRC. So we're an independent agency, okay? But we are funded by the state government, and we were established by an Act of Parliament, the Victorian Law Reform Commission Act. And we are the central agency for developing law reform in Victoria, which is why the VLRC is on your curriculum, because we're the central agency. There are two main aspects to what we do. There are projects that are given to us by the Attorney General. So when Mr. Hulls was the Attorney General, he gave us a lot of projects. At the moment, it's Mr. Pakula who's the Attorney General. And he gives us major projects, which we call references, like the medicinal cannabis. Project, but we can also choose some projects of our own, which are called community law reform projects. So that's a way that ordinary members of the community can get involved in suggesting areas of law reform. Now this, you don't need to copy all this down, and I know there's way too many words there for a PowerPoint slide, but I've just put it there to show you that it is, this is actually part of the Act of Parliament, which defines what the VLRC can do. Now you definitely, for your VCE exam, you must know what are the functions of the VLRC, or they might call it, what's the role of the VLRC. And if you've got a question like that, you must know the five things. And the key words there are in bold. For the first one, examine, report, and make recommendations to the Attorney General on matters relating to law reform that are referred by the Attorney General. In B, you get the same words again, examine, report, and make recommendations. So these are really the critical things that we do. And under B, it's more minor matters of general community concern, which are still important, but that means those are the projects suggested by the community. The other three aspects of the other three functions that we have the power of suggesting to the Attorney General projects for law reform. We monitor and coordinate law reform activity, which means we talk to the other agencies that are involved, like the Parliamentary Committee and the Department of Justice and Regulation, to coordinate and monitor law reform activity. And the fifth one is undertake educational programs, so educating the community. So if you've got a question about what are the functions of the VLRC, you'd have to get all of those five things. So how do we do that? The other critical thing that you need to be aware of is how does the VLRC actually work? What is the process? Now, there is this booklet which was on the table when you came in. If you didn't get one when you came in, then make sure you get one when you go out. It's a booklet of information about the VLRC, and inside there, there's this diagram which shows the process by which the VLRC works. Okay? And you actually need to really understand this and know how and know what the process is before your exam. It starts when the Attorney General gives us a reference or a project, or when we choose one of our own, if it's a community project. Second step is we carry out initial research and consultations. Now you need to be kind of thinking about keywords here. Research is a keyword. Consultations is a keyword because it's really important that we consult very widely with the Victorian community. Our job is to suggest reforms to the law. The law affects everybody, right? So the Victorian community must have input. So we do a lot of consultations. We will often, number three, form an expert panel, right? So that's another key phrase you need to remember. We get experts in to give us advice. In the case of medicinal cannabis, we consulted with lots of doctors, medical professionals, people who could tell us about the medical effects of cannabis. Four, we will publish a consultation paper. We will ask questions of the community. We will say, what do you think? And that consultation paper will be published on our website and will be distributed widely so that everybody can respond to it and tell us what they think. In that consultation paper, we will call for submissions. A submission is a written statement where people will tell us what they think, what their opinion is about the issue. At the same time, we'll go around and we will hold a lot of consultations with people. Anybody who's affected by the issue, anybody who wants to have a say, can have input into the issue that we're looking at. And we'll go all over Victoria, not just in Melbourne, we'll go all over Victoria. Country towns, regional towns, small towns, we'll talk to all kinds of different groups, indigenous groups, different cultural groups, seniors groups, young people. We'll talk as widely as possible because it's really important for the Commission to be inclusive, right? That's a key thing. We're independent and we're inclusive. Then we will receive the submissions, which is anybody can write in and tell us what they think, and those submissions will usually be published on our website. That's another key word you'll need to remember, submissions. And then all of that, the research, the consultations, the expert panel, the submissions, and all of the discussion and debate that we've had, all of that goes into the Commission's deliberations, and we will then use that to write a report. So Mr. Cummins, who's the chair, and the other commissioners will decide on the recommendations which go into the report. And that report is then delivered to the Attorney General, who, as you've just heard from Mr. Hulls, the Attorney General, the Chief Law Officer of the state, a member of the government. Now, after that, the role of the VLRC is pretty much finished. We've written our report, we've made our recommendations. The report goes to the Attorney General, but then the government decides what to do with it. And the government can decide to accept our recommendations and introduce new legislation to Parliament, which Parliament will then debate, or the government can decide not to do that, or they may decide to accept some recommendations but not others. It depends entirely on what the government chooses to do, but that's out of our hands. So this is the process. You really need to know all those steps before your exam. And what we're going to do for the rest of this presentation, I'll just tell you one other general piece of information. This is an overview. Like, we often get asked, okay, how many of your recommendations get accepted, right? Well, we've actually looked back at all the reports that we've done over the years. We've done more than 30 inquiries since 2001, which is when we started. And in at least 75% of cases, those have resulted in changes to the law, either in whole or in part. And sometimes it does take a number of years. Like, it's not the case that we hand a report to the government and then 5 minutes later there's a new law. Sometimes it can take years. I'll give you an example of that. We wrote a report, I think in 2008, I think it was, where, and one of the recommendations was that same-sex couples should be allowed to adopt. Previously, they weren't allowed to. We made that recommendation in 2008, but it wasn't until 2015, last year, that the law was actually changed so that same-sex couples could adopt. So there were 7 years, at least, between our report and the law changing, and that can happen quite often. There can be a long delay, but sometimes it can happen quite quickly. So that's what happened. So that I've just gone over that quite quickly because I think most of you are probably familiar with the fundamentals, but I've just been reminding you of the things you must know for the exam. Now, medicinal cannabis. This was a recent project. We completed our work in August 2015. You may have seen some stuff about this in the news. Have you seen medicinal cannabis in the news? Yeah? Okay. And this was a project that the VLRC worked on, and the result of it was that Victoria has actually now become the first state in Australia to legalise cannabis for medicinal purposes in exceptional circumstances. Right? Now, how did this come about? Well, this is a picture of the Premier, Daniel Andrews, with a little boy called Cooper Wallace, and Cooper suffers from severe childhood epilepsy. He has hundreds of seizures a day, but his parents found that if they treated him with cannabis oil, that actually reduced the number of seizures to a manageable level. But cannabis, as you know, certainly at the time, it was an illegal drug for everybody. So his parents were being arrested, they were being charged with possession of cannabis, and their supply of cannabis was being taken away. When Daniel Andrews heard about this, he said, if I become Premier, we're going to change the law so that cannabis is legalised for children like Cooper and his family. Mr. Andrews was elected, and then almost immediately after coming to power, the government gave the VLRC terms of reference to look at how the law could be changed to make medicinal cannabis legal in exceptional circumstances. These were the terms of reference that we were given. The VLRC is asked to review and report on, there's those words again, review and report on, options for changes to the Drugs, Poisons and Controlled Substances Act to allow people to be treated with medicinal cannabis in exceptional circumstances. And the Commission should report by 31st of August 2015. So they gave us 8 months to work on it, which is not a long time, okay? It's pretty short. Now, so we went through the process that I've described earlier. Oops. Let's see. So I won't go through all of those, but you can see these were some of the things that we did, looking at laws overseas. We had expert panels to advise us. We looked at the experience of other countries, and I'll go into that a little bit with Mr. Cummins in a moment. We published an issues paper. And we received 99 submissions, and we consulted very widely with a lot of people, because a lot of people had strong opinions about this. We decided on 42 recommendations. We did complete our report in time, and the outcome of that was that it did result in changes to the law. I won't go over all the recommendations, but I will say in general terms, these were generally what we decided. We said that cannabis should be brought into the medical system. This wasn't the essential philosophy that we said. We wanted people to be, who were in exceptional circumstances, to be able to get medicinal cannabis like a normal drug, right? From a pharmacy, prescribed by a doctor. Some people said they wanted to be able to grow their own, but we said that's not a great idea for various reasons. We said it needs to be grown and produced in a regulated way, like any other drug. And people will then be able to get it from a pharmacy with authority from a specialist doctor. And we made 42 recommendations. I won't go into them all now, but the whole report is on our website if you want to look at it in detail. These were the medical conditions that we said would count as exceptional circumstances, because that was a critical question, okay? What is exceptional circumstances? Is it if you're terminally ill? Is it, you know, if you can't live otherwise? Is it if no other drugs work? We ended up defining exceptional circumstances as being these conditions, right? I won't go through them all, but including some forms of epilepsy, severe pain from cancer or AIDS, or the treatment for those conditions. Severe chronic pain was another one. And we set out, among our recommendations, we said these are the conditions by which people should be able to access medicinal cannabis if a specialist doctor agrees. So we handed our report to the government, and the government did accept all our recommendations. Now, this does not always happen, but in this case it did happen, and it happened quickly. This is why this is a good case study for you to know about, because this was a case where the VLRC was given a project by the government, we worked on it, we made recommendations, and it's resulted in changes to the law. Only last month, in fact, the Access to Medicinal Cannabis Bill, is now an act, was passed, right, and it received assent. It's been through both houses of parliament, and it's now been assented to. So we now have a new act, the Access to Medicinal Cannabis Act, received assent in April. So you might get a question in the exam that says, give an example of a law that has changed because of the VLRC. In that case, you could say the Access to Medicinal Cannabis Act, the law's changed. Victoria's become the first state to legalize medicinal cannabis, first state in Australia. And the scheme is actually going to be up and running by 2017. That's when people will be able to start getting the medicinal cannabis. So now, I've given you a quick kind of overview of the project, because I think probably some of you have got some knowledge of it already. What we're going to do now is, I'm going to come and sit next to Mr. Cummins. Shall I stay up here? All right. All right. And, well, maybe we can share the mic. Do you want the microphone? So, Philip, if I may begin by asking, one of the things, of course, that the Commission always does when we begin a project is we look at what the law states in other jurisdictions, in other countries. What did the Commission find out about the laws relating to cannabis in other countries?
One of the functions of the Commission is we look at other states and territories in Australia, and then we look around the world to see what is happening, what can we learn to do, what can we learn not to do. We looked around the world on cannabis, and cannabis is illegal in much of the world. You've seen that study on the young child there with the Premier, and you may well be saying, well, why are we holding back if cannabis can help people? It's a forbidden drug in Australia and in many parts of the world. It has some therapeutic and beneficent effects, but it also has downsides. You can get severe anxiety, severe depression, you can get psychosis, you can get heart arrhythmia, you can get numerous negative medical consequences of cannabis. But of course, if it's illegal, people who are using cannabis are using cannabis usually of unknown purity, unknown strength, variable constituents, if a cannabis scheme is run properly under chemical and medical supervision, you should remove the impurities, keep a consistent and safe and known dosage. And that should remove a lot of problems of the illegal market. And one of the things that Nick Gadd touched upon was we didn't recommend homegrown. A lot of people in the community strongly supported cannabis and said, we know what we're doing, we can do it ourselves, legalise all of cannabis. That was not what we were asked to do by government. As you can see, government said medicinal cannabis, that is for medical conditions, not just for relaxation, pleasure, stimulus, THC or whatever, it's for medical conditions. The government further said medical conditions in exceptional circumstances, so it's a narrower category again. Not just general pain relief or general relief, because cannabis does not cure anything. Cannabis is not a medical cure. It alleviates symptoms of medical conditions. And as Nick said, we narrowed it down to those extreme conditions, particularly childhood epilepsy, which you know about. So we looked around the world. We found that in America, a number of states had opened up cannabis for medical general purposes with no strict conditions, and a lot of medical practices were overrun by potheads who just wanted to have cannabis any way they could get hold of it, and this was a way of getting it, and it ran very badly in America and Canada. In Israel and in the Netherlands, it was strictly government controlled in the ways I've just said, dosage provision by doctors and pharmacists, etc. And they had far fewer negative downsides. So we went down that international path like the Netherlands and Israel rather than the laissez-faire, laid-back, problem-creating system in America and Canada.
So whenever the Commission consults, we hear a wide range of public views, of course, and having attended a few consultations, I saw that we had some very extreme views on both sides of the medicinal cannabis debate. There are people who held very strong views about the powers of cannabis and think it can cure many things, although you've just reminded us it doesn't actually cure anything, but plenty of people believe that it does. And then there are doctors who take a much more cautious view and say there simply hasn't been enough research into the benefits of medicinal cannabis. So how does the Commission decide when holding these consultations which views to give the most weight to?
Well, looking at the community, we went right around Victoria, as Nick has said, there was quite a few people who just wanted cannabis legalised generally. But as I say, that was not what we were asked to do. Many people said, don't do it, there are too many downsides of anxiety, psychosis, etc. But we weren't asked to look at the general question, we were asked to look at the medical question. And on that, there was a strong support across the community generally, not just the people who were promoting legalising cannabis generally, but from people who weren't promoting that, there was strong support across the community for a restricted medical scheme, rather like, as I've said, the Netherlands and Israel, and unlike America. So there was a strong community support for the limited proposal in mainstream medicine, as Nick has said. There was, however, quite a strong resistance to the medical profession. And the reason was this. Because cannabis is illegal around much of the world, there have not been any longitudinal medical studies on the effect over 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, 50 years. So if you give a child medicinal cannabis, for example, for shocking epilepsy, and everyone wants to, what's going to happen to the child when they're 20? Will they be impotent? What's going to happen to the child when they're 40? Are they going to get dementia? There have been no longitudinal studies. And as we know, a number of medicines which look like wonderful cures have terrible long-term effects. So the doctors were very concerned. They said, look, it might be a good idea, but not yet. Wait 10 years, wait 20 years. So that was the issue. We took the view, there's a strong support in the community for medicinal cannabis. Safeguards can be put in place. There are no guarantees what it will be like in 40 years' time, but there is immediate, terribly important relief that is needed for these terrible conditions. And if it's done through the medical system, that's the safest and most humane way forward.
And of course, research can continue, can't it, in the meantime?
We encourage, and research is continuing, yes.
So one thing that's interesting about this project, and which is perhaps even a little unusual, is the speed with which it all happened. I mean, normally a project, the Commission will work on a project for at least a year. This time it was only 9 months. And it can take even longer before the law actually changes. So in contrast, the project was completed in less than 9 months. Legislation followed only a few weeks later. Why do you think that happened? And what does that tell us about the law reform process?
Well, the reason it was fast was the new government, made it a priority and gave us the reference on the basis of doing it in that 8-month period, and that's why we did it. That is, as Nick rightly says, an example of a quick reference. Most references take longer because we do widely consult and we do widely research around Australia and the world, so the references do take longer. But the critical thing, I think, is this, as Nick has touched upon. Number one, over time, a little over 75% of our recommendations do come into force as law. Not normally as quickly as medicinal cannabis, but over time they do. He gave the example of same-sex adoptions taking 8 years. But they do come into effect nearly always. But secondly, and very importantly, the recommendations and the reports have a general educational effect on the community. People start thinking about things that they hadn't thought about before. People are prepared to look at things that they previously thought were forbidden or taboo. People are prepared to be more progressive and more creative, such as with same-sex adoptions. So there is a significant educational effect on parliamentarians, on lawyers, and on the community. And that takes a little time, but it's a very good investment.
Yeah, well, it's interesting you mentioned the educational effects of the Commission's work, because one of the things that students may well be asked about in the VCE exam is about the strengths and weaknesses of this way of reforming the law. How do you think this particular project, in addition to that educational point, how do you think the medicinal cannabis project demonstrated the strengths of the VLRC?
Well, I think it demonstrates that politicians do take care in looking at possible negative side effects of medical prescriptions, and that's a very significant thing. I think the community is prepared to take a step forward, but not legalise cannabis generally, so it signifies the input of the community as well. We also, and I think I'll just touch on this because it's important for your exam, there is, as you know, Commonwealth legislation as well as state legislation in the field of drugs. And don't get bogged down in a lot of detail, but you have to know the fact that we are a federation. You often get Commonwealth and state laws that overlap, including in cannabis, because there is an international convention, the Convention on Narcotic Drugs, 1961, which the Commonwealth is a signatory to. You get the Commonwealth Therapeutic Goods Act, where they control the substances which can be prescribed in medicine. So there is an overlap between the Commonwealth and the states on medicinal cannabis. So I think the critical thing is not to get bogged down by a lot of detail, but to be aware that there are two elements, the Commonwealth and the state element. And obviously, if it's an importation into Australia, that's a Commonwealth matter because it's coming into the country from outside. Victoria can't import without Commonwealth approval. So that's why these drugs are to be grown locally and distributed locally. So the Commonwealth has certain powers. The Therapeutic Goods Administration has strong powers, and they look very concerned that we haven't done enough testing yet. So there is, if you like, a tension or at least an interface between the Commonwealth and the state in cannabis. Don't get bogged down with the detail, but do know that difference and interaction does exist.
And that was probably something where the Commission really added a lot of value to this project, wasn't it, in the fact that we were the people who had the time and put the effort into researching exactly what those conflicts would be.
And how to resolve them.
And how to resolve them.
Yep.
Well, so we've talked about the fact that around 75% of the time the Commission's recommendations are acted on, and in this case acted on very quickly, but of course it's not always the case that our recommendations are acted on. And one question that we often get is, well, the government has the power to accept or reject recommendations, so how does it feel if we spend 12 months or 18 months working on a project and then there's no change to the law? Is that, have we just wasted our time?
The critical underpinning is that the Law Reform Commission does not change the law ourselves. Only Parliament, the Attorney General, Rob Holsey in his time, only Parliament can change the statutes, the Acts of Parliament. The Law Reform Commission only makes recommendations. We're not an elected body, we're a highly expert body. We've got numerous retired judges and other people on it, and specialists. We're a highly expert body, but we are not an elected body. So the elected body, Parliament, changes the laws, and that is a good democratic thing. So we make recommendations to Parliament through the Attorney General. And as Nick has said, most of our recommendations are adopted. If they're not, that's part of the parliamentary process. Quite often it takes a little bit of time, and as Rob Hull said earlier, if you take a bit of time, often it then comes to pass, as I think it does with nearly all our recommendations. But the other important thing to note in your Law Reform Commission Act is that the Attorney General, when we deliver the report, has 14 sitting parliamentary days to table the report. That's section 21 of our Act. And that means within 14 parliamentary sitting days, the Attorney, she or he, has to table our report publicly in Parliament, where the whole community can read it and see it. Now that's a very good, healthy thing, because it means if we give the government a report they don't like, or they find embarrassing, or they find difficult, they can't sit on it, they can't hide it, it has to be publicly tabled in Parliament. And that's a very democratic, positive, creative thing.
When we were looking at the functions of the VLRC before, the first two were getting references from the Attorney General, the second one was starting community law reform projects. The third one was suggesting law reform projects to the Attorney General. Is that something that the Commission does very much? Is there an example of that?
Yes, the Commission can make recommendations, can make proposals to the Attorney General. We have a continuous dialogue between the government and the law reform about what we might or might not do. And on a number of occasions we have made recommendations. We're looking at one at the moment of victims of crime in the criminal trial process, which Rob Holtz touched upon. That's an example where we proposed to government that we ought to do it, and government agreed and gave it to us. So there is quite a strong interaction between government and the Commission about what we should be doing. But once we are given a reference, the government does not know what we are going to recommend until they get the report. They can't look over our shoulder and say, oh, look, can you ease back on that one? It might cause us a bit of embarrassment. Please don't do that. Once we're given a reference, we are fully independent. And that's a critical thing. It's good for the community. It's also good for government, because government can say, this was an independent recommendation. It wasn't something we dreamt up in the cabinet room. It's come from an expert body. So the independence of the Commission is a vital underpinning. The government gives us the references, but once we're given it, the government is completely out of it until they get the report, and then they have to table it in Parliament.
Okay, well, one final question from me, and then we're going to hand over to you guys if you have any questions about the VLRC. But just something to leave the these guys with, Philip, what do you think, you've mentioned independence as a critical benefit of the Commission. What do you think fundamentally are the really strong reasons why it's good to have a Law Reform Commission? What does the VLRC offer to the law reform process that the government would not get
otherwise? I think there's three things. The first is consultation, as Nick has emphasised and I've emphasised. We go right through the community and through young people, elderly people, etc., people who break the law, people who abide by the law. We widely consult. It's not a top-down. It's a community-up process, and that's a very valuable thing with the experts we've got, but we go to the whole community. So that's a critical thing. The second thing is independence. We're not a government subcommittee. We make independent recommendations, and the government has to table them in Parliament publicly, as I've said. And the third thing picks up on something that Rob Holt said, and that is we do try and look to creative, innovative, progressive solutions, not just negative holding back of people, but trying to make people have a better community, a fairer community, a more decent and supportive community. So we are a creative, constructive influence in society.
Okay, so at this point, if any of you have any questions that you want to ask about either about the VLRC in general or about the medicinal cannabis project, now's your chance. Yep.
How do you join the VLRC? How are people appointed
to the commission, Philip?
You're appointed by government, so the government has the power to appoint us. The government pays the costs of the commission, and the government makes the references to us. So you might then say, well, that's not looking very independent. But the independence is our process. The government can't interfere with our process. That's what's independent, and of course, tabling it in Parliament.
Okay, any other questions? Yep.
How has the conflict with international treaties and federal law been resolved?
In relation to medicinal cannabis specifically?
Well, the question is how's the conflict between international and national issues and the state issues been resolved? In medicinal cannabis, the way that it's been resolved is the state isn't doing anything that the Commonwealth has authority for, such as importing from overseas. That's a Commonwealth matter. The state isn't doing things which the Therapeutic Goods Administration governs either. We've got an internal state proposal for cultivation, that's growth, so we're not importing. A state one on manufacture, so we're not involved with the Commonwealth Corporations Act or anything like that. It's with intrastate manufacture and in distribution to the medical system. So Commonwealth has been, in effect, kept to one side. But I think what will happen is, we're seeing it in New South Wales, we're seeing it in the Commonwealth. I think, after your exam, no doubt, but I think you'll find that the whole of Australia will progressively come on board in this way. But this is the first step, as Nick has rightly said.
You think probably that other states are looking at Victoria to see how well it works?
No doubt about that. And if you're looking at federalism, one of the downsides of federalism is it can be very messy. You've got numerous governments around Australia, including the Commonwealth, can be slow and expensive. One of the upsides is you can have states getting ahead, like Victoria has on medicinal cannabis, and that then has a flow on benefits to the Commonwealth. So there's pluses and minuses in federalism.
Any other questions? Yep.
So, as you mentioned that sometimes the Parliament is not accepting your input, so what are the main reasons, as you have consulted with the expert panels and have positive ideas on something that you're proposing to Parliament, so what are the main reasons that they not agree to your recommendation?
Well, the government, in the end, has the decision-making power. They're elected by the people to change the statutes, the Acts of Parliament. So the government has that right. So we understand that. So if, in fact, the government doesn't implement it, we understand that's a legitimate role of government. We are not elected. So that's the first thing. The second thing is, over time, it nearly always does get implemented, as I have said. The other thing is this, once we've given our report to Parliament, we do not go around like a political party and campaign. Plenty of people do, but they're not us. So in this case of medicinal cannabis, there'll be still plenty of people campaigning for wider legalisation of cannabis, and some people campaigning against it. We don't run a political campaign. Ours is much more knowledge-based, specialist-based, into Parliament, and then we keep out of it. We don't go around running a campaign ourselves, but other people can do that, of course. But I mentioned one other thing while we're just moving on a bit from medicinal cannabis. Be careful about, Rob Hulse mentioned television, that Parliament's not like just what it is on television. Be when you're seeing, as you will, you do see, a lot of law on television, American television, English and Australian, it's nearly always on crime, nearly always on dramatic cases. Television is very good on the drama of the law. It's very good on social issues, inequality. It's very good on moral issues. It's very good on science and DNA. What it is not good on is your legal procedure. Don't get your legal procedure from television. It's different in the States, different from England, and it's different from Australian television. Get your legal procedure from your teachers, they're the experts, and your texts and your materials. Sure, get interesting moral issues from television and drama, but get your procedure for your exam from your teachers, and they're the experts.
And just going back to your question, one other reason why the government may not act on our recommendations is governments change. Okay, we may be given a reference by one Attorney General and one government. There may then be an election, the government may change. And we would still complete that reference, but we would be then giving it back to a government which may have a completely different set of priorities. So the normal democratic process may have something to do with it. Okay, any other questions?
We better stop for time.
Yeah, okay, time to stop.
We need to wind up, so our very, very good wishes, and we both agree with Rob Holes. If you want to have a go, have a go.
Thank you.
I hope everyone enjoyed their morning tea break. I hope everyone got a good muffin or a good cookie or more than one. She had some quite generous catering. I hope you enjoyed the first two sessions of Law Week Law Talks, and I'm really, really pleased to be able to introduce the Victorian Ombudsman, Deborah Glass, who's going to present the next session. This is the first time we've had the Victorian Ombudsman speaking at Law Talks, and we're hoping it's the beginning of a really great relationship. So I hope you are a really great audience, because that might make a difference as to whether we will ever get the Ombudsman to come and speak to us again or not. So Deborah Glass, the Victorian Ombudsman, has had a very interesting and diverse legal career. She's worked overseas, she's had a variety of roles. The Victorian Ombudsman is a very significant and important role within the Victorian legal system. So please welcome Deborah Glass to the stage. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I want to first acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which this university stands, and I'd like to pay my respects to their elders, past and present. Now, I'm Deborah Glass, and I'm the Victorian Ombudsman. So does anybody here know what an Ombudsman is? Anybody? Quick show of hands if you have any idea what an Ombudsman is. Funny word, isn't it? Yeah, okay. It's all right, this is not, you know, you're not going to get any marks or anything taken away from it, but if anybody's got any, if you're Googling it, actually that doesn't count.
And,
oh, okay, you read the brochure, okay. Anybody, well, that, you get marks for that too. You know, if you picked up my brochure and you, anybody like to venture without actually reading from the brochure what an ombudsman is? Yell out.
Okay.
Go on.
The ombudsman is you. She is an independent officer who reports directly to the Victorian Parliament.
Okay, thank you very much. What I'm going to be doing today is talking a bit about what an ombudsman is and does, and give you a few examples. But basically, yep, I am an independent officer of Parliament. I am actually, an ombudsman is a kind of independent check on the power of the state. Now, what does that mean, and how does that fit into to the law and to Law Week? Well, you know, the state is a big place, and there are lots of people in it, and it's fantastic actually to see today such a diverse group of people coming to hear about an ombudsman and about what an ombudsman is and does. Because I'm actually the ombudsman for all Victorians, and that means whether people are young or old or rich or poor or whatever their background, wherever they've come from, there is one ombudsman for Victoria. And what I want to do today is tell you a bit about what I do, what the office does, give you a few examples, but I'm going to start actually with a very brief history lesson, because this person here might just be the first ombudsman. This is, you can't quite see the top of it, it's cut out, it's 494 BC. And that is, I don't know what his name is, but he was a tribune in ancient Rome. And the whole idea of you know, the state is this big, powerful place. You know, the state is, you know, your local council, government departments, all of those things, big, powerful place. And they've got a lot of power. And you, the citizen, member of the public, what have you got? You've got none. So what you need when you're a member of the public is somebody you can go who can actually provide a check on that power. And the first ombudsman, probably, and it wasn't called an ombudsman, was a tribune in ancient Rome, because what he did was have the power to veto legislation that was not favourable to the people. And actually, it also goes back not just to Western times, but this is in Korea. This is something called the Secret Royal Inspector. And this is 16th century. And this is in what's called the Joseon Dynasty in Korea. There was a guy who used to go around, a kind of mystery shopper. You know, he would actually go around and check on government officials and see whether they were presiding and whether they were corrupt. And then he would announce himself for having observed the proceedings. And if they were corrupt, he would rehear the cases. So there's been a few type of ombudsmen around, but here's the first actual ombudsman. And this is 1810 in Sweden. So where does the word ombudsman come from? It is Swedish. And it's a funny word, which we've sort of kept over the years. And anybody here from Sweden? Anybody with Swedish backgrounds here? No, very diverse. Ah. Well, you probably better correct my pronunciation. But I'm always hoping nobody will be able to here. Reichstagsjustizieombudsman. How was that?
Yeah, that was pretty good.
Oh, good. Excellent. Fantastic. Oh, work. Great. Parliamentary agent for justice. You know, so the ombudsman was the creation of the Swedish Parliament back in 1810 to be a check on the power of the king and the executive. So, am I an ombudswoman? What do you think? Actually, I'm an ombudsman, because the word technically, I think anyway, although it's a bit of a debate about it, is gender neutral. So although there are probably in the States people who call themselves ombudspersons, I actually regard myself as the ombudsman. So that's the background until we get into the 20th century, and this actually is New Zealand in 1962. This is the Attorney General then. So there we had an ombudsman. You know, so we've always had these bodies over some form who provide a check on the power of the state. But after the Second World War, what happened in Commonwealth countries is that people began developing their own ombudsman. And the reason for that is about the imbalance of power between the individual and the state. And that was particularly apparent after the Second World War. So what countries began doing, and New Zealand was the first, was setting up an ombudsman. And the ombudsman was about a place that people could go if they had a problem with the state. And in good old Victoria, and I'll just, you know, I'll move us right along, we go back to, the ombudsman is 1973, so it took about 150 years after Sweden set up the first ombudsman to get in Victoria an ombudsman who actually is the official parliamentary check on the balance, on the power of the state. When I say the state, I mean all representatives of the state, whether it's government departments, local councils. There are over 1,000 bodies that are actually within the state's jurisdiction, people who make decisions about things. So I'm actually the fifth Victorian Ombudsman. I have a 10-year term, and as I like to remind members of Parliament, that is 2.5 times the term of government. You know, you get rid of the Ombudsman. What if they don't like the Ombudsman? What if they don't like what I do? Very much, you know, I investigate governments. I investigate the actions of governments, not politicians, but the bureaucracy. And so the nature of that you make decisions that people don't like. So can they get rid of the Ombudsman? Well, what it takes to get rid of the Ombudsman, let me tell you, is it takes a joint resolution of both Houses of Parliament. So it's not easy to get rid of the Ombudsman. And that's deliberate, because the Ombudsman is an independent officer of Parliament. And you need to be able to actually have the kind of job security that allows you to do things that are not popular and to say things that are not popular. And what I'm going to do, because actually it's a very powerful job, and I've got the powers of a Royal Commission. You know, I can summon evidence, I can require witnesses to speak to my delegates. So it's a powerful office, and it needs to be if you're investigating the state. Now, you know, at this point I would often spend quite a bit of time explaining what the office does, but we actually made a little video, which I'm hoping is going to work. I'm just going to play this.
Welcome to the Victorian Ombudsman. We deal with complaints about more than 1,000 state and local government agencies, from councils and prisons to statutory bodies like VicRoads and WorkSafe. Our role is to make sure their decision-making is fair. In weighing that up, we look at the circumstances surrounding a complaint, including what the law is and the agency's policies and procedures. If you think you've been treated unfairly, the first step is to try and resolve your problem with the agency. If that doesn't work, you can contact us. You don't have to be over 18, and you can remain anonymous. In some cases, another person can complain for you. You can complain to us about something an agency did or didn't do, or a decision it made. For example, if you made a complaint but the agency is taking months to respond, or the agency says they've fixed the problem but you're still not satisfied, or they've made a decision that you think is unfair. You can also come to us if you feel an agency has infringed your human rights. We understand you may be feeling frustrated by the time you speak to us. Try to explain your complaint in a few key points, including what happened and when. Tell us what you'd like to happen, and remember to send us relevant documents. We'll assess your complaint and decide on a course of action. If we think we can help, we'll try to resolve the matter informally, and in some cases, we investigate further. When we're finished, we might make recommendations to the agency on how it can improve. In some cases, we'll present our findings to Parliament, so the public knows what we've said, and the lessons can be learnt by the whole state government. By helping government agencies to improve, we create a better experience for everyone. We don't deal with complaints about the police, courts, politicians, or employment issues. There are some other limits on what we can do too. For example, if your complaint is very old, or there is another body that can deal with it. If you're not sure what to do next, get in touch, and we'll try to point you in the right direction. You can find out more about where we can and can't help on our website. Otherwise, you can email, call, write to us, or make a time to come in and see us. Head to ombudsman.vic.gov.au for more details. The Victorian Ombudsman. Free, fair, independent.
Learn something from that? You'll find that on our website. It's actually available in about 6 languages now, community languages. So we've got, so by all means take a look, ombudsman.vic.gov.au. But so why does the Ombudsman exist? Basically because life's not fair, is it? And you need to have a place to go. Can't deal with all the unfairness of life, obviously. But when that unfairness comes from a government agency, you know, local council, government department, you know, whether it's, you know, then you need to have a place to go where you can say, hey, hang on a second, you know, that's not right, doesn't feel right. So, you know, governments, they're big machines, they've got lots of processes, you know, they've got lots of people working for them. And actually, as I said earlier, my job as Ombudsman is to keep a check on that imbalance that is created with those big government machines that are busily making decisions that affect people's lives, you know, your lives, your family's lives, your friends' families' lives. And what I'd like to do is just give you a few little examples about how that works in practice. But also, I know that this is Law Week, and I think I answered you all here because you're thinking about doing law or being lawyers or having interest in the law in some way. And I thought it was worth reflecting just for a moment on, when I give you these examples, on what the difference is between the Ombudsman and the courts, because actually we're both in the business of resolving disputes. Courts are also in the business of fairness. You know, things like that, something isn't fair, you've got a case to make, you can bring your case before the courts. So, you know, there is clearly some parallel between what I do and what a court might do. But a few differences, quite a few, and I won't dwell on all of them because I would be taking most of the day. But the Ombudsman is free, which a court isn't. And the Ombudsman isn't always constrained by the law, which courts are. You also don't need to be a lawyer or to have a lawyer to come to the Ombudsman. Quite a lot of other differences. One of the differences, though, is the decisions I make are not legally binding. And I'm going to talk a bit about how that impacts on the sorts of things that we do and don't do. But, you know, that's where there are other ways of getting to the same place. And I'm just going to give you a couple of examples. So I want to tell you first about a couple whose name was Mr. and Mrs. Fawzi. I bet none of you have heard of Mr. and Mrs. Fawzi, would I be right? Mr. and Mrs. Fawzi? No, wouldn't have heard of Mr. and Mrs. Fawzi. Anyway, they have a farm in Gippsland, a very hilly part of Gippsland. And they on their farm they have sheep and cows and, you know, other things. And, you know, it's a family farm. There they are. Very remote part of Gippsland. And what happens one day is there is a very, very heavy rain and there's a landslip and their road becomes completely inaccessible. And there's only one way to get to the farm, this road, and they can't get there. So they complain to the council. They complain, you know, look, you've got to fix the road, we've got to get back to the farm. And the council just doesn't do anything. They say, oh, it's not us, not us fixing it. It's got to be emergency funding from the Commonwealth, you know, somewhere else, you know. So for about a year, all these different agencies are busy passing the buck to everybody else about fixing this road. And in the meantime, Mr. and Mrs. Fawzi cannot get back to their farm and their sheep are dying. So they finally make a complaint to the Ombudsman. And the this was just before my time, actually, but I think it's a classic case for Ombudsman. The Ombudsman started making inquiries. My staff began making some inquiries and what's going on, you know, with the council. And it was still taking their time. Nothing much was happening. So the Ombudsman then launched a formal investigation into what the council was doing to fix that road. And I'm happy to say that 2 weeks after the start of the formal investigation, the road was fixed. So it's true that Ombudsmen actually can't enforce their recommendations, but actually they get results. And if you compare that to the courts, you know, interesting to think about, you know, could the forces have gone to the court to say, you know, fix the road? I think they probably couldn't have. I think they would not. I think a court would not have given them a legal remedy. But what an Ombudsman can do is not just think about what's lawful, but also, was it fair? Was it fair to expect this couple to wait while all these government agencies argued about who was responsible for fixing the road? No, I don't think it was. Here's another example. Now, some of you may recall this video. Let me get this to play. Flinders Street Station. This is. And this is a... and here is a 15-year-old girl who is, I think the technical term is a fare evader, I'm afraid to say, because she was at Flinders Street and we'll get there in a minute and you'll see, just watch this for a moment. So she's leaving and these are a couple of authorised officers. You're very familiar with authorised officers. We know about authorised officers. You probably encounter them. Exactly. Yep. Well, now I won't, you know, the rest of this video is on the website. You see there's her friend there complaining and, you know, having a bit of a go at her too. She's actually left. This is in full view of hundreds of people at rush hour at Flinders Street. So it's pretty grim, isn't it? Anyway, we actually have a Charter of Human Rights and Responsibilities in Victoria. Were you aware of that? Hope you're aware of it, because you actually heard from the architect of that charter this morning, Rob Hulls. He was the Attorney General who brought in the Charter of Human Rights and Responsibilities. And one of the things about the Charter is that people actually have rights. You know, they have rights to, you know, including about freedom of not only freedom of speech, but actually liberty and freedom from degrading treatment. And that didn't strike me as being something that we would be very proud of in Victoria. So anyway, that became an investigation for the Ombudsman, you know, because actually under my Act you can complain about breaches of human rights if they're committed by, you know, agents of the state, and these authorised officers, believe it or not, are people who are supposed to comply with human rights provisions and act compatibly. So human rights breaches don't just happen in, you know, remote parts of the world like Syria. They can happen in the Melbourne CBD. So I did an investigation into this. This was a $2.50 fare that this 15-year-old had not paid. And the question that we were asking there was, you know, was this proportionate, that response of the state, the state's agents, which is what ticket inspectors are, to that $2.50 fare? Well, I didn't think so. And I concluded in that her rights had been breached. And that actually Public Transport Victoria needed to do quite a lot about how it dealt with young people and how it dealt actually with customers in general and in relation to the service they provide. Because they were saying to me, actually, you know, the authorised officers are supposed to be in the service business. And I said, well, you could have fooled me. So tabled that report in Parliament, and that's what I do with my major reports. I table them in Parliament and they have an impact, including the training of authorised officers in future. And I hope that you will see that for yourselves, actually, how things will be different when there are problems on the network. So a couple of examples. I'll give you just one more example. And this is, I'm going from, just to illustrate that we deal with complaints from teenagers, and we also deal with complaints from very old people. So this is the other end of the spectrum. Now, this is a complaint that came in from a 91-year-old man named Alan Lorraine. Now, he was a resident in an aged care home in Melbourne. So, you know, and this place was full of people who could have been your grandparents and your great-grandparents, because there were quite a few of them who were in their 90s, and some of them were over 100. And what happens in these places is that they had, most people in this facility had sold their family homes and put the money from their family homes as bonds into this, given it basically to the proprietors of the aged care home, where it's supposed to secure their care in their old age, you know, for the next, 10, 20, however many years. And what happened with this aged care home is it went bankrupt. The place went bankrupt and took with it $4.5 million of residents' money. So it's basically people's life savings. These old folk were wiped out. And one of them, pretty feisty old chap, made a complaint. And everybody complained to them, because he said, because this wasn't a government-run facility, but it was actually a place that was regulated by the Department of Health. And he thought, something must have gone wrong if this place went bankrupt. What were they doing regulating this? How could that happen? And he just got pushed around. As you see from the quote, they just got pushed around. Because, he wrote these wonderful old-fashioned letters. No emails for Mr. Lorraine, no apps, nothing like that. He used his old-fashioned typewriter, two-finger typewriter, and would produce his letters, which he'd send to everybody. Nothing happened. So he finally complained to the Ombudsman. And I said, some of my staff, we get lots of complaints, began having a look. Now, we had a look at the files in the Department of Health, and we found all kinds of things, including that this place had not filed proper financial records for about 25 years. Lots of examples of things that shouldn't have happened, and all in that time, the registration is just being renewed. So what happens? It goes bankrupt, and the department says, not our problem. Well, we didn't think so. So we thought, So I turned that one into a formal investigation where I've got my Royal Commission powers. And one of the things I did there was actually, what was the fair outcome for these people? What would have been fair? There they were. They've been kicked out of this place because their money's gone. What's fair? Well, I thought that what was fair, actually, is for the government to make an ex gratia payment to these people. A lot of money, but for a fair number of people, but actually, that's what should have happened. So, as I said, I can't enforce my recommendations, but what I can do is table reports in Parliament, and I did. I tabled that report in Parliament, and I had sent that report to the Minister before I tabled it. In fact, I'd written to the Minister in the process of doing that investigation, and I'd said, Minister, this is so serious that I'm minded to recommend that the government make this payment. And I know, it's a lot of money for a government to pay, but, you want to think about it. So, I'm giving you the chance to do that. So when I tabled the report, I wrote again to the minister. I said, dear minister, here's the report. Because I wrote to you back in December, I'm letting you know now that I'm recommending formally that the government make this payment by the 30th of June. That's in a couple of months' time. And actually, Minister, I'd like to know what your formal response is to my recommendations by the end of next week. So I can't enforce my recommendations, that's true, but I can monitor them and I can publish them. And I told the residents of Benturn Gardens that, and I told them that I would be doing that. So the Minister's office was aware that I am going to publish whatever the Minister decided. And I said, you know, Minister, this is entirely a matter for you. I can't enforce my recommendations, you know that. But I will be very public about what you say. And this is what I think is called the persuasive powers of the Ombudsman. You know, in the old debates they talked about, you don't have the power to enforce, but the Ombudsman has persuasive powers. And I like to think that it was the result of the persuasive powers of the Ombudsman that the government agreed to my recommendation that they make an ex gratia payment. And I'm very happy to say that everybody who was eligible, who lost money, actually was compensated. And I think that was a pretty good result. So, anybody thinking at this stage, that sounds like quite a fun job? Well, what I thought I would do is I'd share with you at this point, how do you become an ombudsman? Any ideas? Well, you apply, that's one thing. You know, actually there was a job advert and, you know, there it was, Victorian Ombudsman, apply here. But I thought that I would just give you a bit about my career journey, and I'll be brief about this because I started out as a lawyer. That's the first thing you need to know, probably the only thing you need to know really. So I did law, and I knew on my first day I didn't want to be a lawyer. I thought this is really boring, William Street, terrible place. I don't, you know, dull. Nope, not for me. So I knew on day one I didn't want to be a lawyer, but actually I stuck at it long enough to earn enough money to get a one-way ticket and leave. And I did. So this is actually not me, but that's what I did. One-way ticket, put a pack on my back, and I went off to Europe. Now, I mean, I am particularly fortunate in that regard, because although I did what millions of young folk do when they've been working for a few years and have enough money just to get off and backpack, I do actually have family in Switzerland, so I fetched up in Switzerland, and I just kind of fell into a job there in investment banking. In fact, I really wanted to be a writer. Yeah, I didn't want to be a lawyer. Wanted to be a writer. I realised I wasn't going to make a living as a writer. I wasn't even going to pay for repairs to my rucksack as a writer. And what you do in Switzerland, you know, they have bankers there, and they actually were hiring lawyers. It was an American bank. I thought, well, nothing else to do here. I'll take the job that was on offer. And that actually got me actually quite interested in the whole world of financial services, which is a pretty remote world in some respects, but you know, quite an unusual one. And it actually got me to Hong Kong. So I spent 10 years in Hong Kong after Switzerland, where I became a regulator. You know what a regulator is? Regulators basically set the rules for things. So I made a switch from working for a bank in the industry to where you set rules for industries. So, you know, you set codes of conduct for people's good behaviour. It's basically working for a government agency that keeps the markets honest. So it's the beginning of my journey in what you might call the integrity world, you know, which is working in the public sector to keep people honest. Went from there to the UK, where my heads are cut off. There we are. These are none of the people I worked for, but actually, I became the chief executive of something called the Investment Management Regulatory Organisation. Again, funny world. You know, only woman on the board of a UK company, and it was an interesting journey, which I was quite eager to bring to an end because there are limits to how you can put up with these things. And I think probably the main, some of this is going to be cut off, but the main job I did in the last 15 years was in the UK before I came into this role. And some of these headlines might resonate with you. I was with a body called the Independent Police Complaints Commission. So I spent 10 years investigating, well, more than that actually, investigating police complaints and corruption in the United Kingdom. And these are examples of some of the cases that I was dealing with over the period. So every time the police would shoot someone or somebody would die in police custody or police corruption stories, including the Hillsborough saga, that generally ended up with me, or at least my organisation, and most of them were with me. So it was a pretty tough gig investigating the police, but that actually is what was the precursor to my coming back into this role. So, yep, here I am. And I came to an end of a 10-year term in that journey, so we've cut off the tops of the heads of the previous ombudsman. But it's an interesting one, because I actually was out of the country for nearly 30 years, and there's a wonderful quote I'm going to share with you, which comes from T.S. Eliot, and it goes like this. We shall not cease from exploration, and the end of all our exploring will be to arrive where we started and to know the place for the first time. So I find myself back in Melbourne doing what I think is the best job in the state. Being a constitutionally independent officer of Parliament, being able to make decisions in the interests of justice. And that's not just what's lawful, but also what's fair. And finally, I'm just going to say one thing about this from the cover of my annual report, because actually in my office we have a lot, we actually hire a lot of lawyers. And we hire a lot of people who have done law and haven't practiced. Because they've done it and they've thought, yeah, that was interesting, but I don't. They probably had the kind of reaction that I had when, on my first day working in William Street, you know, this is boring and I don't want to do that. And I think that one of the points I want to leave you with, you know, should any of you decide that you're going to be, you know, do law, that you do become lawyers, there's a lot more to a legal career than actually being a lawyer. And quite a few people in my office are in that category, and they do all kinds of things. They do investigations. They, you know, they answer the phones. They deal with training. You know, they deal with lots of stuff. Actually, they use their skills in a whole lot of ways, because it's something about the analytical skills you acquire as in a legal education that sets you up for a whole lot of really interesting types of work. And I love this quote. And I'm just going to leave you. You know, and I hope we've got some time for questions. I think we do. Yep. But I just want to leave you with this quote, which comes from an Irish statesman called Edmund Burke in 1775. Isn't that impressive? It is not what a lawyer tells me I may do, but what humanity, reason, and justice tell me I ought to do. Because that, for me, actually, is the guiding principle of the ombudsman. The world over, it's the principle behind my office, that this is about, this is not about, you know, what the law says is lawful. You know, all those examples I gave you, you know, the Fawzies and their road, Mr. Lorraine and his aged care home, the teenage girl being, you know, basically assaulted by a ticket inspector. The law didn't actually have remedies for these people, but the Ombudsman's Office did. And that's where I can look at what is fair and what is just in a much broader way than the legal system itself. So I commend it to you, and I commend to you, you know, if you get to practice the law, there's a big wide world out there, and I really wish you well with it. And I'm really happy to, we've got some time, to take some questions.
Any questions?
Yeah, have we got can people hear if we, we've got a question in the front?
Yeah, sure. How did it become an ombudsman? How did it become an ombudsman?
To be the ombudsman or to work for the ombudsman?
Yeah. And how many ombudsmen do we have in Victoria?
That's a very good question. There is one Victorian ombudsman. So there is only one person who was appointed actually by the governor and council on a 10-year term to be the state ombudsman. But there are other types of ombudsmen. There are industry ombudsmen, you might have heard of the telecommunications ombudsman, the energy and water ombudsman. So individual agencies set up their own ombudsman services. So there's more than one, and there are lots of complaints commissioners who do ombudsman type work. So there's only one who does my job in the state. But there are other people who do complaints type handling work elsewhere. How do people get to work for the ombudsman? We advertise. We advertise a lot, actually. We're always hiring inquiries officers. In fact, we take a lot of law students to people who actually work on the phones in my office. You know, we have a call centre where people deal with the public and deal with their complaints and their issues. So we, you know, we advertise at universities. So keep an eye out. Actually, that's we've got a very young, dynamic staff, very committed, very passionate.
Another question up here. And this isn't actually a microphone, but I think I'll tell it to the voice get picked up for the purposes of recording.
You might have to yell. Go on. I could almost have planted that question. Thank you for asking it. You know, one of the powers I have is that I don't need to have a complaint. I can actually act on what's called on my own motion and investigate whatever I like. So there are a couple of things I'm doing at the moment on my own motion. I'm investigating the enforcement of ticketing systems. So, you know, the Mikey enforcement system. If you're picked up without a valid card and you have to have a conversation with an authorised officer about whether you should pay a penalty fare or go to court. You know, that I'm investigating that. So I get a lot of complaints about it, but actually I don't have to get a complaint in order to launch an investigation into any aspect of what goes on in Victoria if it's in my jurisdiction. So yeah, the work I do is a mixture of the kind of dealing with individual complaints, but also the big systemic stuff that just because it's important. Yep, question then.
How long did you work in the law firm before you realised that it wasn't really?
Oh, about 5 minutes. I knew on the end of my first day this was not for me. And it was, look, this is a little unfair, you know, this is the 80s I'm talking about here, and it's a lifetime ago, you know, for, you know, or several lifetimes ago for some of you. And I think in terms of, you know, what it's like for women, it was probably worse then than it is now. But there, you know, part of it was a sense that as a young female lawyer, you have to be so much better than a man to get to the same place. And I thought, look, if I really cared about the law, I would have said, you know, damn it, I'm going to get there. But I thought, I don't really care about this. You know, it just didn't do it for me. So although I actually learned some good skills, because I couldn't afford to, you know, I mean, I had to work, you know, and earn enough money to get out. And I did actually learn some good skills while I was working as a lawyer, including about negotiation and, you know, bluff and counter-bluff, and actually how little your legal education really contributes sometimes to the work you do as a lawyer. But it was a very quick feeling that, hey, this is not for me. And I do find it quite funny that coming back after 30 years, you know, the legal profession, you know, wants to own me as one of them. And my initial reaction was, I'm not a lawyer. I left that all behind. But actually, in a broader sense, yeah, you know, I am part of the legal landscape, but in a different kind of way. If there's any others, I'll come back to you if we haven't got it. There's a question here. Oh, it's just a fan. You know, what's the most enjoyable thing about being an ombudsman? Just, you know, you actually have this incalculable opportunity to make a real difference to people's lives. You know, every day. You know, you get to make decisions in the interests of justice and fairness. And, you know, I don't want to suggest that it's always sweetness and light, because actually when you're in the complaints business, you also take a lot of flack. Because you make decisions that people don't like. And sometimes, you know, fairly often, in fact, you know, we'll deal with a complaint and we'll say, you know, yeah, what the agency did was reasonable. You know, what they did was actually was fair. And the complainant won't like that. And they'll say, no, it's unfair, it's outrageous, you know, you've got to do something about it. And we'll say, well, no, we've made the decision, it was fair. So you sometimes deal with people who are not happy. But even that, you know, that sense of satisfaction you get by just, you know, doing the right thing. And that includes making decisions that are not popular. And knowing they can't get rid of you. other questions? Yep, one up the front here. Sorry, I've got a light in my eyes here, so if I can't see, you might have to wave a bit.
Do you have to have any prior qualifications to work for Ombudsman?
We generally take people who either have degrees or who are studying in some way. It really depends on the job. And I think, I mean, if you see If you see positions advertised for, you know, people in inquiries offices, for example, we'll be very clear in the job spec, you know, what we're looking for. But there's no, what I would say to you, you know, when you're getting to the point that you're in the job market, there is no substitute for passion. You know, I mean, yes, you know, the qualifications are incredibly important, and the education you get from your schooling, from higher education, is fantastic. But what will really take you places is having a passion for something and demonstrating that passion when you apply. I can probably tell you a lot of things about how not to apply for jobs, because I've seen a lot of CVs in my time. And one of the things you don't do, for example, is send the kind of form letters where you write to 100 different agencies and you forget and you get some of the typing wrong, and you write to the Ombudsman's office about how you're really passionate about working for another agency because you've forgotten to check your letters. And you look at these things and you think, whoa, we don't want to hire that person. No attention to detail. So, you know, if you can write, if you're a good communicator, if you're sensible, if you've got passion, if you care about, changing the world always helps. But being realistic as well, there's some things we can't change. And you express that, with the jobs you're going for. I mean, I really commend to you the sorts of things that you can get into an application when that will make you stand out from all the other people who are applying for the same job. Other questions, thoughts? Can't anybody else? Let me come back to the front.
Yeah, I just wanted to know if you're solving people's problem for free, so where do you get paid from, and who supports you to help?
Well, I am paid. Well, like any government agency, I'm funded from the Department of Premier and Cabinet, who funds all the other agencies. So essentially, part of the public sector, broader public sector. My staff mostly are public servants, so they are like other public servants, and they're on the same, rates and as public servants. So yes, what I run basically is a small public sector agency that is fully government funded. And it's an interesting point, which if any of you have an interest in politics might reflect on, how does an ombudsman who is independent of government actually get its funds from government, and does that present a conflict with government? And the answer to that question is, I think, yes. So, but actually, what do you do? So one of the things that I'm asking for, and I've put this in my last annual report, is that I think I should be funded directly from Parliament rather than through government. But at the moment, I'm not, and the office never has been. And it means that every year you've got this tension because you're investigating parts of government, you're investigating often the same parts of government who are dealing with your budget bid. So it's the trouble with being an ombudsman, which is a fantastic job, wonderful being independent, but you also have no friends. So, especially in government when you're asking for money. Other questions, thoughts? In that case, really great. You've been a fantastic audience, and I really wish you well with your studies. Whatever you decide.
Well, a little bit like our previous speaker, I am one of those people who went off to study law. I finished school and I didn't really have much of an idea of what I was going to do, but a whole lot of my friends were going off to study arts law or commerce law. That was pretty much the choice of those who were interested in doing double degrees in those days. And I was lucky enough to get into doing arts law, and my arts degree was I majored in English and in history. And then I completed my law degree, but there was an intervening factor. I was a university student at the time of the National Service Act. The Vietnam War was on, and there was conscription. And my birth date, marble, came out of the barrel, and I was called up for national service. I had been a member of the university squadron, which was like the reserve air force for university students at that time, And so when I went into the RAAF to do my reserve training, I ended up as an officer. Then, as soon as my university life had ended, I had to go off and do my national service. And I got posted, first of all, to Laverton, which is not very far out of Melbourne. And one day, after about 6 months, I was approached by one of the education officers, and he sort of looked at me rather oddly, and I could see that a question was coming. And he said, "Would you like to do some teaching?" And I sort of looked back at him and said, "Teaching what? To whom?" And his response was, "Well, we need somebody to teach some English to the apprentices. Would you be interested in doing it?" And so I did, and I thoroughly enjoyed it. I enjoyed it so much that when I finished my national service, I went back to university, did a diploma of education, and I've been a teacher ever since. So I thought that at that point that law was behind me. But then all of a sudden, one year, a new subject appeared, and that subject was called legal studies. And the school that I was at asked me if I would be interested in pioneering that subject at the school. And so I read through the curriculum document and had a bit of time to anguish over it, and finally decided, yes, I would. And so I've been teaching legal studies ever since. Up until a couple of years ago, I was still teaching English as well, but the last couple of years I've been specialising in legal studies. And in 1981, I was asked if I would join the Law Week committee, and that was the very first Law Week. And so I've been involved with Law Week ever since. I now work for the Victoria Law Foundation, and I also work as teacher in residence at the Sir Zelman Cowan Centre in the law faculty at Victoria University. So I've sort of come all the way back to, in fact, being very deeply involved with law. Now, I'm aware that today we have a group of students who are combined. There are some people here studying Units 1 and 2 legal studies, and others who are doing Units 3 and 4. But what I'm going to say to you is relevant to both groups. It's not peculiarly relevant to those doing Units 3 and 4, and for one very important reason. All of you are using the same study design. Those of you who are in Units 1 and 2 will be the last students to use the current study design. It will run through till next year, and in 2017, a brand new study design will come on board. So everything that I say today is relevant to both groups, to those undertaking Units 3 and 4 legal studies, which of course means that you have an external examination at the end of the year, and that those of you who are facing Units 1 and 2 will almost be at the end of Unit 1, I imagine, having finished your criminal units, and be drawing slowly into, beginning anyway, shortly, to look at the civil units that make up Unit 2 legal studies. Now, those who are looking at Units 1 and 2, if you just forgive me if I tend to be focusing on those who are undertaking Units 3 and 4, but what I say is equally as relevant to you, although it may not kick in for another little while. I'm going to talk a little bit, first of all, about preparing, and this applies to both groups. How can you best prepare yourself to do the best you possibly can in VCE legal studies? Apart from listening to what your teachers have to say, doing your homework, your assignments, and getting those in on time, and being well prepared for your outcomes. One thing that both groups can do is to make sure that you're familiar with the study design. Now, you don't have to go out and buy a copy of it. You can download it if you haven't already done so, or if you haven't, it hasn't been given to you. Go to the Victorian Curriculum and Assessment Authority website, vcaa.vic.edu.au, and download your study design. For those who are doing Units 3 and 4, all you need to do is download Units 3 and 4. But for those doing Units 1 and 2, I'd be inclined to download the whole lot, and so you're doing it again next year. Okay, it's a bureaucratic document. So what's the point of it? The point of it is this: that you can't be tested on anything that's not in that study design. Now, you've heard a lot of really useful stuff today. I'm not going to add to that useful stuff in terms of the content of the study design, but what I'm going to suggest is ways in which you can maximize your use of that information. You can make the best possible use of it. And one way is by ticking off the subjects that you tackle, the units that you tackle, via the study design. And those of you who are doing units 3 and 4 will note that what I've provided you with in this document is, in fact, a knowledge audit. You'll find, as you work through it, pages 6, 7, and 8, this is a knowledge audit for units 3 and 4. Now, if you're in units 1 and 2, don't just chuck it under the seat and leave it behind. It'll be useful for you next year as well. The study design, together with that knowledge audit, and quite obviously I've written the knowledge audit from the study design, you can simply tick off the bits that you reckon you've got under control. And I don't mean at the end of the year, I mean as you're working through, as you get to the end of each topic. Do I have appropriate notes? Do I have appropriate depth and detailed knowledge of the topic that I'm working on? Are my topic notes up to date? Now is the time to make your topic notes, not September, October. If you're making your topic notes in September, October, you're not revising. You're starting off your preparation. So use the knowledge audit, use the study design to ensure that you know exactly what you have to cover. Now, for the units 3 and 4 people, I would suggest also that you download yourselves a copy of the Constitution. Not so relevant to the 1-2s at this stage, but certainly for the 3-4s it is. Now, don't panic. You don't have to know the Constitution. There are about half a dozen bits of it that you do need to be familiar with. But one of the best ways of understanding those half dozen bits is to see where they fit into the context of the whole document. For example, if you have in front of you the Constitution, you've already looked, no doubt, units 3-4 people, at sections 51 and 52, or parts thereof. Have a look at the whole thing, and it'll make a lot more sense when you begin to see it in context. As I said, over the course of the year, for those in units 3 and 4, you really will concentrate on perhaps no more than half a dozen bits of that Constitution. But your understanding of it will be much greater, much clearer, if you understand how those bits fit into the whole document. It's particularly when you're looking at things like the separation of powers, chapters 1, 2, and 3, all set out there very clearly. Again, you don't have to know what they are. By that I mean you don't have to memorize them. But if somebody's talking about chapter 3 courts, you'll know what they're talking about if you're sufficiently familiar with the way the document is structured. So particularly for the 3-4s and the 1-2s can certainly get ready for this for next year. Download yourselves a copy of the Constitution. You can go buy one at the government printer or at some newsagent sometimes, but you don't need to do that. You can download it for nothing, print it off on a school computer, and put it into your folders. It's an important document to have. Now, as I said before, make your topic notes as you go. Now, you've heard a lot today from Rob Hulls, from Nick Gadd, and from Deborah Glass. Wouldn't be a bad idea, when you go home, jot down a paragraph of the key points raised by each of them. What does an ombudsman do? Who is the ombudsman? What are her powers? That sort of thing. Because when you're looking at dispute resolution, there's one of the elements, one of the means by which disputes can be resolved in this state. If you make just a little set of notes, give yourself maybe 20 or 30 minutes, make some notes on each of those content elements today, and you'll remember that, and you may find that it's useful in your outcomes. It may even be useful to the 3-4s in the exam at the end of the year. The bad news is that you need to make sure that you cover all topics in the study design. So those of you who are drawing to the end of Unit 1, you need to make sure that you cover all of the elements in Unit 1 for your school-assessed coursework, for your outcomes. Same applies for the outcomes in 3-4, and most particularly for the exam at the end of the year. Don't leave any gaps. Don't just concentrate on your favourite topics. I made that mistake as a law student at university. I loved constitutional law, and I loved tort law. Couldn't stand property. Guess what? First crack at property, I failed it. Had to do it again, which was distinctly embarrassing. But it was my own fault. I couldn't blame anybody but myself. I had to go back and redo property. And I've never forgotten it. Still don't like property. One very important thing to do is to make notes in a particular way. Now, if you're dealing with cases, those who've been doing Units 1 and 2 will be familiar with a number of cases relevant to criminal law. You'll have had a look at some quite specific cases. A case where, for example, the definition of murder was established, and so on. Those doing Units 3 and 4 will be looking at constitutional cases. Units 1 and 2, Unit 2, you'll be looking at probably the most famous civil case in history, the case of Donoghue and Stevenson, the snail in the bottle case, when you come to Unit 2. Very important to make notes with regard to cases in this way. Now, you might have your own technique. This was mine, and it got me through a law degree and some postgraduate study in law. Forgot to mention that before. I went off to the UK a few years ago, and I completed a master's degree. And it was in law too, so I couldn't escape. I'm a bit of a legal tragic, even though I never thought I was going to practice early on. How do I report cases? How do I remember cases so that I can make sense of them in an exam? I record them in accordance with their FIDS, F-I-D-S. Facts, issues, decision, significance. I did it as a student on a what's called a system card, a little envelope-sized card, and I put FIDS down the left-hand side. A few words as to the facts of the case. What's the case about? Who did what to whom? The facts of the case. Need to be able to respond to that. Issues. What's the issue? And in a constitutional case, the issue might be, does the Commonwealth have the power, or do the states have a power? So the issue that the court had to resolve is the second way of recording a case. Facts first, issues next. Decision. What did the court decide? In whose favour did the court determine the action? Facts, issue, decision, and significance is very important. What's the significance of the case? Now, in a constitutional case, it might be that it altered the previously understood balance of power. It might have tipped power in favour of the Commonwealth or tipped power in favour of the states, less likely, but it may have done that. That's the significance of it. But significance has another meaning as well. If any of you come across the 3-4s, I'm probably going to ask this question of, come across a case called Grace and Fraser. Grace against Fraser, actually. It was a criminal matter. Anyone come across it? It's a very simple case. Early 80s, it was 1981 or 1982, and it's significant for a number of reasons, because you can use it as an example in about three different parts of the course. Grace and Fraser is a case about a lady who left the handbrake off on her car when she parked it. Miss Fraser parked the car, caught the tram, she drove her car to a tram stop, parked her car, and caught the tram into town, did a day's work. When she got back, she found that her car had, I've left the handbrake off. The car had rolled into the car in front and had damaged the car in front. Now, Miss Fraser wasn't a particularly thoughtful person. She just got in her car and went home. But unbeknownst to her, somebody had written her number plate down on a piece of paper and tucked it under the windscreen wiper of the car that her car had rolled into. And so that person came back, stamped their foot, got very cross about the damage done, went straight to the police station and reported it. Next morning, knock, knock, knock on Miss Fraser's front door. She's charged with, as a driver,
leaving the scene of an accident, failing to report damage. Went to the magistrate's court and was convicted. Now she spoke to her lawyer. Her lawyer said, "Oh, I reckon we can have a bit of a razzle with this. We can appeal this." So the matter was appealed to the Supreme Court. Justice King, not Betty King, not Justice King of the glasses. This is an earlier Justice King. Justice King decided, looking at the Motor Car Act, driver leaving the scene. Ms. Fraser's counsel said that she wasn't the driver. At the time the incident took place, she was in her office in the city. She was not the driver who left the scene of the accident, and so her conviction was quashed. The magistrate's decision was overturned. She was held to be not guilty of that offence under the Motor Car Act. Okay, so why am I rambling on about this trivial case, this seemingly trivial case? This applies to the Unit 1 and 2 people as well, of course. We know what the facts of the case are. We know what the issue was. The issue was she the driver? Therefore, was she liable? The decision, ultimately the Supreme Court said no. She was not the driver, therefore she was not liable. Okay, what's the significance of it? It's threefold. And this is where you can use cases, and this is why the significance aspect is a really important element to note. The significance of it, first of all, is that it's an example of an appeal on a question of law from the Magistrates Court to the Supreme Court. And you can use it as an example. If you're looking at issues of jurisdiction, okay? If you're looking at issues of jurisdiction, it's an example of a matter that can be appealed on a question of law from the Magistrates Court to the Supreme Court. That's where appeals lie, questions of law from the Magistrates Court. That's its first significance. The second significance of that case is it's a very good example of what's called statutory interpretation. In other words, Justice King, in his wisdom, interpreted the meaning of the Motor Car Act very narrowly. He said, driver, that's the person that's got their little pink grippers on the steering wheel at the time the incident occurred. She wasn't doing that. She was in town. Therefore, she was not the driver. So the court interpreted very narrowly the meaning of the legislation. Now, it's significant for a third reason. And those of you in Units 3, 4, when you're looking at the relationship between courts and Parliament, can use it as an example of this. Because the Parliament said, having received the notification of the outcome of this case, the Attorney General would have been a bit cross about it, and probably the Transport Minister as well, the Parliament decided that's not what we meant at all. We didn't mean driver as just the person who was in the car at the time it occurred, but the person who was responsible for the car. So what did the Parliament do? It amended the Motor Car Act. It amended the legislation. So it's an example of all of those three things. It's called Grace against Fraser. Grace was the copper. That's the process of identifying magistrates' court matters. Grace against Fraser. Fraser was the alleged offender. It's significant for those three reasons. So if on your bit of paper where you've noted facts, issue, decision, significance, you indicate that you can use it as an example in three different parts of the course, that's useful stuff. And you might find that quite a few of the cases you look at, they might have multiple significances, if you can have a plural of that word. So think about your cases from that point of view. Are you covering the facts, the issue, the decision, and the significance? As I said before about bits of the Constitution, there are probably only about half a dozen or so cases that you really need to know in reasonable detail. So if you've got that information jotted down about them, flick through it every now and again, refresh your memory on those cases, you'll be able to use them efficiently and effectively when it comes to writing about them under exam conditions or in an outcome. I suggest you do the same thing with regard to pieces of legislation. Again, there won't be very many pieces of specific legislation that you need to be familiar with, but the same process. Jot down what it is and why you're jotting it down. Why has my attention been drawn to this particular piece of legislation? How is it relevant to the work that I'm doing? Also very important to familiarise yourself with primary source material. Have a look at the websites of the courts from time to time, particularly the Supreme Court. News is popped up there on the Supreme Court website pretty regularly. Some of it's sort of housekeeping news, like as of the 1st of May, judges in the Supreme Court will not wear wigs, which has no doubt thrown the wig makers into a bit of a panic, but never mind. Have a look at the court's websites. There's useful news on them. If you need to track down detail on particular cases, then Ostley is your source for that. And the website is www.austlii.edu.au, and that's in the notes that you've been handed out this morning. Past papers, and this is particularly relevant for the 3-4 students. Have a look at the exam papers over the last few years back to 2011. Don't go back beyond that, because that's when the current study design started. You go back before 2011, you might find yourself panicking and revising stuff that ain't on the paper. So look at the past papers. You may well find that your teachers will have a packet of those ready to hand out to you as the year progresses, but if not, nothing to stop you downloading them yourselves. And also, might I suggest, you have a look at the examiner's reports on each of those papers, because the examiner's reports contain information about how well questions were answered, or how badly, the sorts of errors that are commonly made, the sorts of problems, sorts of issues to avoid. So I would strongly urge you to have a look at that. It's a valuable guide to the kinds of questions that are likely to be on the paper at the end of the year. Not necessarily the specific content, but the style of question. Bearing in mind that the exam at the end of the year is all compulsory questions. Unfortunately, there's no choice. You have to answer all questions. And the past papers of the last few years do give you a very clear idea of the sorts of questions that can be asked, and the way in which examiners expect questions to be answered. Also, and particularly for the Units 1 and 2 people, look and listen. Watch the television news. Read the newspapers. Have a look at what's current in the legal world. Because your subject, unlike many of the others, is what's going on out there right now. I'll go back to my office at Victoria University later in the morning, and I could find that when I look at my daily blogs, things that come into my computer, there'll be all sorts of interesting stuff about cases that are being dealt with today or have been concluded. I get a regular feed from the High Court on their judgment summaries, all of that current stuff. Legal studies is about what is really happening today. Okay, the exam, marked out of 70. It aims to assess a pretty large part of the study design. As I said before, don't omit any part of the course in your examination preparation. Don't ignore the difficult bits. Get help. Get help if you need assistance to unravel the difficult bits. And don't specialise. When you get to the exam, and this is again for the 3-4 people, read the exam paper very carefully. It always concerns me when I see people waiting for the starting gun to go off in an exam. See people who've been given the paper, who have 10 or 15 minutes reading time, sort of gazing around and checking their fingernails and looking at the furniture, looking at the people in the room. Not a great idea. You need to be preparing what you're going to write when the supervisor tells you that you may commence. Two questions for every question that you answer, whether you're doing an outcome in Unit 1 or Unit 2, or you're doing the end of year exam in Unit 4, or some other subject, the questions are, what's the content and what's the task? What's the content is quite simply, what's the subject matter I'm supposed to be writing about? What's the stuff that this question is asking me to write about? What's the content? What content does the examiner in this question want me to deal with? And the second part of it is, what's the task? What am I being asked to do with that content? Now, to assist you with that, if you turn over in the documents that you've been given, you'll find that I've provided you with, in this document, with a series of common task words used in examination questions. Now, I'm not going to go through those today, you'll be pleased to know, but you should familiarise yourself with those common task words, particularly when you start having a look at past papers. It may not have crossed some of your minds that there are such things as specific task words and that they have particular meanings. Some of your teachers may have gone through this very thoroughly. So I'm sorry if I'm repeating it. But anyway, repeating it doesn't hurt. Have a good look at the task words and make sure that if you are asked to explain something, you're not simply listing it, not simply describing it. Look at the task words, look at exam questions, ensure that you're matching your response to what the question is asking. There's nothing worse, and I was a marker for many years, there's nothing worse than marking a paper which is full of interesting stuff, but where the student has simply failed to do what the question requires her or him to do. You don't get much marks by way of doing that. Get to the exam centre on time, give yourself plenty of time, don't be there too early, and work yourself into a nervous wreck doing that. Bring plenty of pens and rulers, sounds like real motherhood stuff, doesn't it? But do bring plenty of pens, rulers and all of that. And look, for heaven's sake, if you're going to cross something out, this is why you bring a ruler, it ain't maths, but bring a ruler, so if you're going to cross something out, you do it neatly. Don't score the thing out. If you've put a line through something, that is a perfectly clear indicator to the examiner that that's not part of your answer. You do not have to obliterate the paper. The last thing you want to do is to get the examiner offside by presenting something that's truly hideous to look at. And some papers can be. Try to be neat. Some people, you know, if you've got lousy handwriting, write every second line. You're entitled to do that. If you run out of paper, you can ask for a booklet. They won't give you one unless you ask for it, but you're entitled to one. There's extra space given at the back of the paper as well, if you need it. But try to be neat. There's nothing worse as an examiner, 11 o'clock at night, you've got your papers all due in tomorrow morning, and you've got something on the desk in front of you that looks like some sort of demented insect has fallen into a bottle of ink and staggered over the page. All the teachers in the room have seen papers that look like that from time to time. Allocate your writing time carefully. Don't spend too much time on your short answer questions and then run out of time for the extended response questions, which tend to be the ones that are later in the paper. The paper's marked out of 70. You've got 120 minutes to complete it. Now, a rough rule of thumb, or a very specific rule of thumb, if you look at it that way, you've got 1.7 minutes per mark. So don't spend 7 or 8 minutes on a two-mark question, because you're going to run out of time if you do that. Part of the task in your reading time, just to get a look at the geography, the topography of the exam paper, and just sort of mentally sort out how you're going to utilise your time. Look at the wording of a question. If you're asked to provide one example, provide one. Pardon me. You don't get any bonus points for providing two or three or four or five. If it And the examiners will look at your first example if they want an example. They won't bother about the others. So don't waste time and effort providing more than you're required to provide. My suggestion always is start at the beginning of the paper and work your way through to the end. And that might seem pretty obvious, but some people might suggest, oh, I'll do the difficult questions first, or I might do the extended response question first. Well, yeah, I reckon that it's better to start at the beginning. A bit of a dress rehearsal, working through the short answer questions, warms you up to the extended response questions later in the paper. You're less likely to miss a question. You might gain time answering the short answer questions, which you can utilise in the extended response questions later on. As I said, it might give you the opportunity to warm up. How much do you write? You do not have to fill every line on the paper. Some of you will. Some of you might have big loopy handwriting, some might have very tiny handwriting. You are not expected to fill up every line. And as I said before, you get extra space, extra writing space at the end of the examination paper. And in an urgent situation, desperate situation, you can ask for a script book and it will be provided. It doesn't happen very often, very rarely do people ask for it, but it is certainly possible should you need to do so. Don't leave the exam room early. If you're finished with 15 minutes to spare, I know it's hell, but go back through the paper. Reread it. Make sure if you're numbering the questions, if you're putting numbers into the questions, make sure that you're using the right ones. Make sure that if you're putting statistics in, just give it a bit of a double check. Finish the paper with a few minutes to spare. It's worth spending those few minutes just looking back over what you've done. Sometimes, and I know this only too well, because I do a lot of writing, and I can't proofread my own writing. I know I read what I want to see, rather than what's actually there. And in an exam, you don't have the luxury of having somebody else read it for you, but it's still worth going over it, because you may well pick up errors. You might leave out a word. You might say that something is not efficient, when you mean it is efficient. Now that might seem terribly obvious, but occasionally, you know, our minds get a bit fuzzled during exam time. Those sorts of things can happen. Now, the rest of this document, I'm not going to take much more of your time. There are some practice questions there, some ways of looking at various questions. One important point that I will make, pardon me, is don't use dot points to answer a question. Write your answers in full sentences. If you're down to the last 2 minutes, and it's question 14, and you have four ideas that you haven't yet canvassed, that's about the only time where you should be just dotting at the end. But other than that, write your responses in full sentences. That is repeated time and time again by the examiners. They want to see full sentences written as answers. You don't have to write even your extended response questions. They're not essays. Go straight to the guts of the issue and get stuck into it. Don't waffle through a beautifully literary preamble. You get no points for that. The rest of this document, I think you should give a bit of attention to it in your own time. With your knowledge audit, you can tick yes or no. Those doing units 1 and 2, don't throw it away. It'll come in handy for you next year. It's the same study design. Does anyone have any questions?
Now I'm going to say that's great, because rather than encourage you to ask questions at this stage, because it's 12:30, and we all need to make our way and be able to Old Melbourne Jail by 1 o'clock. And since you guys just have a lunch break, so thank you.